Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean the bare necessities are Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life. Wherever I wander, wherever I roam, I couldn't be found off my big home. The bees are buzzing in the tree to make some honey just for me. When you look under the rocks and plants and take a glance at the fancy ants, then maybe try a few. The bare necessities of life.
Good morning and welcome to Breakthrough Entertainment, brought to you by the Breakthrough Thinking Broadcasting Network, right here on KPHX 1480 AM live in Phoenix. I am Joseph J. Erdo, next to Trisha, and of course, Blue behind the glass is Eric Reinert.
No, I'm not Blue.
Oh, come on.
I love Blue.
Oh, when you pick a raw paw.
And you prick a raw paw.
Yeah.
When I was a kid, I thought his name was Blue.
Don't pick the
prickly part by the paw. When you pick a pear, try to use the claw.
But you don't need to
use the claw when you pick a pair of the big paw. Breakthrough Entertainment's Jungle Book Show. This is Phil Harris singing The Bare Necessities. I have a feeling that we're not going to be able to sleep for a few nights after today's show because this song's a few times during the show today.
I'm sorry, but I love The Bare Necessities.
I do too. Well, and you know, last year we had, just try and relax. Oh, I like so just calming, you know.
Uh-huh.
You're working too hard. Fall apart in my backyard.
So the Jungle Book takes place in Asia, right?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, so why is there a Dixieland jazz band playing behind Baloo?
I don't know.
Because he has good taste.
I'm looking around.
See, this is a good life lesson.
There's something you want that can't be found. When you find out you can live without it and go along not thinking about it.
That's so true, you know? You just got to take the bare necessities. Right?
But, you know, isn't it bare, like B-A-R-E?
It is.
And so that's why Dave didn't show up, because he didn't want a bear at all, you know? He was
bear
afraid
at all.
He was afraid it might scare off our listeners, you know, if
that's
they
true.
Saw us all with the bare necessities.
I noticed Dave got a haircut.
Yes, he did.
Yeah.
Yes,
was that at your prompting?
No, we actually had a huge weekend last weekend. It was our nephew Matthew's bar mitzvah, and it was wonderful, but we wanted to look nice.
Cool.
Very nice.
But
did,
like
he dye his, did he dye his hair, too?
Like, no, he just got 10 years younger.
I think he put some Grecian formula in there or something.
Probably, just for men or something like that, but we don't want to give them shout out. No, I'm just teasing.
Well, you know, Baloo in the original Jungle Book in the animated version, he was gray, and now
had
the
little,
Bill Murray
just,
version
just had
is
a little bit
brown
of,
bear.
Yeah, yeah, well, just a little bit of gray.
Yeah, yeah.
It makes you look distinguished.
Yeah, that's true.
I like
true.
It.
Well, of course, the new adaptation of the Jungle Book live action adaptation came out yesterday, and we're going to be reviewing it. We are going to also be playing songs from that film and the original and the sequel. Lots of different.
Wait a minute, and the sequel?
Yeah, well, the sequel to the original,
okay.
Jungle Book 2.
I was going to say, they're going to do another Jungle Book 2?
They are, yeah. Because this one's getting, you know, some really good box office and reviews.
Talk about sold out at 9:40 at night.
Wow.
Yeah, at 9:40 at night. So we're not talking about the little kiddos going.
Yeah, wow. Well, so we'll find out what I thought of it, and you saw it, I assume?
No,
you couldn't get in. Okay, all right.
Well, actually, it wasn't sold out when we first tried to get our tickets, but there weren't two together.
Oh, okay.
And then when we decided, well, even if we can't sit together, we'll just go ahead and go because of the other things that were available at the time.
Okay.
And then it was sold out. It was like, oh my gosh, they had gone from having, you know, second row tickets.
Yeah.
And a few sporadic onesies to completely sold out.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
At the Dine-In Theater. Yeah. Yes.
Well, then, you know how we love to have our We'd love to bring the movies to life, so we'll also be speaking with jungle expert Jackie Witt. She's with Adios Adventure Travel. She's been to a lot of these different jungles and rainforests, so she's going to let us know, you know, what it's really like. And then she'll also tell us, you know, of course, her company, Adios Adventure Travel. They can help us embark on our own adventures.
But the big question is, has she eaten monkey brains in the rainforest of Peru?
We'll have to ask her. Of course, we ate crickets 2 weeks ago. And,
that's,
you know, Baloo
right.
eats the fancy ants.
And I have been to the jungles of Peru, but I have not eaten the monkey brains.
Oh.
My ex has, but not me.
Okay, well.
But he has
poor
monkey brains.
Wow. Okay.
I'm teasing.
Well, you know, if you have monkey brains, or maybe you don't, you're going to want to make sure that your car is up and running very well, right? So, and this segment or this hour is brought to everyone by the Alexander's Auto Repair.
All Care
Automotive. Mm-hmm. Their website is alexandersautorepair.com. And, right, you've been there.
Oh, my gosh. Alexander is the greatest. And he has worked. I mean, this man is trusted by owners of these extremely expensive collector's cars, things like that. He helped me out when I was in a bind, actually came in after hours to accept my vehicle that was towed in by the tow truck. And, I mean, just a great, great guy. And you can't, he's honest as the day is long, and he does fantastic work. Never had to take anything back to him at all for a redo.
Excellent.
And just absolutely fantastic.
Well, he's located at 3310 East Thomas Road. Again, that's 3310 East Thomas Road. Give him a call at 602-956-3781. That's 602-956-3781. Again, that is Alexander's All Care Automotive.
Yes.
And if you want to give us a call, of course, you can reach us at 602-252-1480, 602-252-1480. If you've seen any movies, maybe you've seen The Jungle Book or something else. My microphone is just spinning all around here.
I noticed that.
Yes.
It's got a little problem. I think we need to drop a blue pill in it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, then, but give us a call. Let us know if you've seen any movies. Maybe you were out at the Phoenix Film Festival. You want to give your comments on that or anything else, just give us a call. Oh, they're worried.
Oh my God, we're in the jungle.
We're in the jungle.
Yes.
That was so fast.
We're in the jungle, baby.
Oh yeah.
But are we naked and afraid?
No.
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 We're hanging out with Baloo.
Yes.
I love
hanging
that.
Out.
Well, yeah, because that, you have to sleep in the tree, right?
Yeah, that's what we meant. Oh.
Oh, sorry. That's actually what I meant. Oh.
Okay.
Sorry.
No, it's all good. And you know what? There's a lot of other movies that open this weekend as well. And
I was actually amazed because I didn't realize that there would be that many movies. I mean, we kind of went through a little bit of a semi-dry spell.
Yeah.
Where there wasn't a whole lot of new stuff coming out. And then it's like, boom.
I know. And we've got 13 cameras. This is a creepy new movie out. It's a thriller, a voyeurism thriller. Can't wait to talk about this one.
Ooh.
Yeah, we're going to be speaking with actor. I'm going to try my best here. We'll have to ask him, but I was Neville. Right?
Neville Archambault.
Neville Archambault.
That's my guess.
Yeah, probably. He plays the bad guy in the film,
mm-hmm.
And so can't wait to speak with him. And also, we will have on co-writer and director Florian Gallenberger on behalf of Colonia. Have you heard of Colonia Dingy Dodd? Eric?
Only because you sent that to me.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, it's an ex-Nazi cult from which nobody escapes. Yeah, it's an actual place.
Nobody escapes or no one can leave?
Well, nobody can leave. And well, I have here nobody ever escaped.
You can check out anytime you want, but you can never leave?
Well, there's five people, I think, escaped in history, but that's very few, right?
Yeah. There was one of those films that you sent that actually had some real actors in it.
Well, that
some famous actors.
Yeah, well, and this one, of course, is Emma Watson.
That's the one.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's Colonia, and we'll
Harry
be speaking...
Potter fame.
Yes,
yes,
yes, and Daniel Brühl, and then also Michael Nyquist plays the bad guy in that. So can't wait to talk about that one, and we'll also I know we didn't get to talk about last week's releases. So in addition to the Adderall Diaries, which opened up yesterday. Some other ones that opened last week. High Strung.
Yes.
I'm sure that mm-hmm. you're probably really interested in that one, right?
Definitely.
And I tried to get someone on behalf of that, but everyone's pretty busy with that. And then Mr. Right with Anna Kendrick and Sam Rockwell. And One More Time, starring Mr. King Louis himself, Christopher Walken.
Ooh.
Yes. So, should be a really great show today.
I think so, definitely. And
Christopher,
you know,
Walken's going to be on?
No, but he's in the movie. He's in two of the movies.
Oh.
He's in One More Time, and then he also plays the big monkey guy in The Jungle Book.
King Louis.
Yes.
I don't know. I want to be like you.
Ooby-doo.
Yeah. But, you know, the thing is that I don't know if I grew up with Jungle Book. To me, Jungle Book has just always been there. So I must have grown up with it. But even my kids loved it. And obviously now, even the new remake is just very, very popular.
Yeah.
So there's just something about that recipe that they had with that. It's a winner.
Well, you know, Disney's been doing a lot of these redos, adaptations, live-action adaptations.
Renovations.
Yes.
Moneymakers.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. Well, and there's, of course, Cinderella last year. That was an amazing film, right?
Oh, yes. I want that dress and I want those shoes.
Yes. And then the year before that, what was it, Maleficent? And yeah. You know, and they're making several other ones. Peter Pan was just announced. They're going to be making live-action Peter Pan.
Well, you know, when they said that these were going back into the vault, never to come out again in this century back then, I was like, okay, I think I know what they're doing.
Yeah, they're remaking them and making more money.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You can only make so much money off those old cartoons. I mean, kids today are a little more sophisticated than they were back then.
And the thing is...
Even toddlers.
Well, they want more action and stuff, too. And this Jungle Book has a lot more action, and it's a little more violent than the cartoon version, the animated
version.
Violent? Well, you know, there's a tiger, so Shere Khan.
Did you see Two Brothers?
Yes.
That was a good movie.
Yeah, that was good. Ooh. That was good.
Wow, for Eric to give that kind of... That's like a glowing... That's like a glowing review from you.
Yes, I thought it was going to be a family film, but dang, they kill the tigers.
Well, yeah.
Wow, yeah.
It's a little realistic, you know, they don't pat it there. And but of course, it all kind of started with 101 Dalmatians, right? That was great. But now they're going to make another one of that. They're making a movie called Cruella.
Oh.
So I don't know how you could do that without Glenn Close. You know.
Yeah. Well,
she's not going to be.
Oh, you know for sure she's not. Well, yeah, it's going to be really hard for somebody to follow up on that.
Yeah.
Talk about a phenomenal actress.
The one I'm looking forward to the most is Dumbo. I can't wait to see how they do that, and they are doing that. I think
they're
it's Tim
doing
Burton.
Dumbo?
I think Tim Burton is behind that one, Dumbo.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. And Alice Through the Looking Glass is coming out soon, of course.
Yes. Yes.
And
Johnny Depp.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And also.
The wild zony flying elephant.
Yeah, Dumbo. Oh.
Did you ever see an elephant fly?
Well, I seen a horse fly.
I seen a dragon fly.
I seen a house fly.
that's a little bit racist. Come on, Eric. Come on.
A little. Hey, I didn't make it.
No. But, yeah, I can't wait for that, though. And then, of course, like I said, we're going to be hearing a lot of Bear Necessities today a few different times. And remember last year we couldn't get out of our heads after Tomorrowland came out.
Yes.
It's a small world after all. And so I think that's probably what we're going to be feeling after today, is that little hangover from the Disney-itis.
Oh, right. Well, hey, you know what? Bring it on. Disney, I'm sorry. I know that they're out to make money, but Walt Disney, who was out for the love of it, at least at the start, he did things right.
Yeah.
That's all I can say. He did things right.
Oh, see?
Yes.
Yeah. Good job, Eric. Oh, well, I'm sorry. I was just enjoying it. Small world after all. Oh, those wonderful little puppets. Oh, I love it.
I love the ones that go like this.
They're not puppets. They're animatronics.
Yeah, they're animatronics.
Yeah, that's true.
But I like the ones
Polynesian
that dance. The little Polynesian. Well, those are...
Yeah,
that was fun. And the hula girls.
Yeah.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
But I think they did a great job on that. And even that. Oh, my gosh. I went for the first time during the holidays.
Yeah, they changed the whole thing over.
The entire thing, just like the Haunted Mansion, the entire thing for Halloween or Christmas is all switched up. Yeah. It's amazing.
I haven't seen that since I was just a little boy. I've got to see that. You know, I've seen it on YouTube because, you know, the people will go through, but that's not the same.
That's what I'm watching right now. And it's funny because the guy is filming it on his phone and he points it up to like something that's above him and you can see the ceiling. Kind of ruins the whole thing.
Aww.
Well, you can see the vents in the ceiling.
Well, Disneyland's a little different than the Disney World one. I've only seen the Disney World one. And Disney World, the clock and everything is.
But you know, they're renovating the entire thing. They made it into a gingerbread house for Christmas.
Wow.
They made it into the outside of it into a gingerbread fantasy. It was amazing. They did most of it with lights, of course.
It's still my favorite ride.
But it's oh, really? Okay.
I mean, I know it's simple, but it's just it's just happiness, you know?
Right. Well, that's why I guess when you said your favorite ride, because I look at it, you know me, I look at it less as a ride and more as
an experience,
just an
type
experience,
of thing.
And yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But well, you know what I really want to do?
What?
And I don't know if I'll ever be able to do this until I'm much, much older, maybe. But I want to get that book about all the inside secrets, like going into the Mad Hatter's hat shop and looking in the mirror and watching the Cheshire Cat come out at you and go away, and the little puppy dog up in the window that pokes out for the fire station, and little things that Walt put in there that, unless you take time to just sit there
Easter eggs.
And watch, they're all Easter eggs everywhere. There are a bunch of Easter eggs throughout Disneyland.
Yeah.
I think there are in Disney World too, but not nearly as many.
Yeah.
And I just really want to do that. I want to just go and find all the Easter eggs. I think I want to do an Easter egg hunt. It'll probably take me a week.
One of the things he did was he put Mickey's character everywhere.
Exactly. Yeah, there's a bunch of those of the little silhouette of Mickey.
Yeah.
I don't know if silhouette's the right word, but the Mickey insignia is everywhere.
Logo,
that's good. Yeah, except
they're a moneymaker. It's a logo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and of course they are making a It's a Small World movie as well. So I think we mentioned that. Yeah. Yeah, so I can't wait for that. They're working out all the kinks of the animatronic. But they are making that, so we'll still find out what that's you know. So they're gonna be making a lot of all these. You know, I think even Jungle Cruise is being made into a movie. I don't know why you need Jungle Cruise and Jungle Book, but I think Dwayne Rock Johnson is in Jungle Cruise.
Do you smell what the Rock is cooking?
Okay, on that, I'm not sorry, but
I absolutely love Dwayne Johnson. Yes. He's a San Diego boy, too.
And before we get to Jungle Cruise, let's return to Jungle Book with Bill Murray, the new Baloo, singing Bear Necessities from the new Jungle Book movie. Again, it opened up yesterday, and we'll be reviewing it right after this break, find out what I thought of it. But before that, we need to take a break and listen to Bill Murray with the Bear Necessities. We'll be right back to Breakthrough Entertainment.
Wherever I wander, wherever I roam, I could be fond of my big home. The bees are buzzing in the trees to make some honey just for me. You look under the rocks and plants and take a glance at them fancy hands and then maybe fly a few. The bare necessities of life will come to you. Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. La-di-da. I mean the bare necessities. That's why I'm back and rest.
It's now time for the word association game. Contestants, go ahead.
Bars. Meat market. Gas.
High prices.
Politicians.
Liars.
Auto mechanics.
Ripoff. Guys, whoa, wait a minute here. Not when I think of my auto mechanic, I think of trust, care, safety, and fairness. This sounds like the definition of a friend, which was what Alexander's All Care Automotive Repair achieves with his customers. The peace of mind that comes with the mechanic that puts you first. Located at 3310 East Thomas Road, Phoenix, 85018. Call 602-956-3781. 602-956-3781.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Birenbaum and Spean PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you. Communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Birenbaum and Spean works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
Now I'm the king of the swingers, oh, the jungle VIP. I've reached the top and had to stop, and that's what's bothering me. I want to be a man cub, and stroll right into town, and be just like the other men. I'm tired of mugging around, oh, ooby-doo. I want to be like you. I want to walk like you, talk like you. You see, true, an ape like me, can learn to be human too. Now don't try to keep me
I'm sorry. I'm just sorry.
Wow.
Sorry.
He's got a wild side.
Sorry.
So much for being a man cub.
I'm Joseph J. Erdo. Welcome back to Breakthrough Entertainment, brought to you by the Breakthrough Thinking Broadcasting Network. And right here on KPHX 1480 AM live in Phoenix. And beside me is Trisha.
Woohoo!
And keeping us in line and adjusting the mics when I go into monkey mode is Eric Reinert. Oh, yes. Yes, thanks for turning the knobs, Eric. Good job. That's all Eric does. No, Eric's much more important than that. Well, of course, this is I Wanna Be Like You, Louis Prima, The Jungle Book. Oh, and then there's, of course, Phil Harris in the background, right?
Yeah.
Yes, I believe so. I believe so. Oh, and of course, then Blue comes out in that the coconut bra and everything, right?
Yeah.
Very memorable part of the Jungle Book. And you're a little loud in our ears right now. I don't know if there was something different, Eric.
That's on my side here.
Okay. Well, you hear me though, right?
No, you don't hear me. Oh, see,
now
there
I
am.
Now
yeah,
I was. Now I
hear Where
you.
Was I before, Eric?
I think you're out in the jungle.
Yes, I can hear you now.
Loud, very loud and clear. No, it's very loud and clear.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Well, you know, if you have to replace a light anywhere on one of your vehicles,
yes,
if it's something that's really... Yes. Well, no, if it's something that, you know, is really tricky to get to, because I will tell you, the brake lights, you know, the upper one, not the ones on the side, but the upper one that some cars have in the top of their trunk, and some of them have it back by their back window.
Yes.
Well, ours on the SUV that we have, I said, oh my goodness, I know how to change light bulbs, you know. But the way that they're putting these cars together now, it was amazingly difficult for me to get in there and get that and change it out. It was amazing. So,
Yes, Alexander's All Care Automotive is the place to go. And, of course, you're going to go see him.
He's at 3310 East Thomas Road, right there in Phoenix, Arizona. Not too far from here. And let me tell you, you won't find a better mechanic.
Yes, absolutely. And, of course, the phone number is 602. I'm trying to pull it up here because it's...
I'm sorry. 602-956-3781.
Yes,
and he's open on the weekends till 2 on Saturday.
Yeah, so if you've got problems today, you want to take care of it today, don't let it go. And Eric, I think we hear you for some reason, just so you know.
That's right. It's because he's working hard, and we can hear all of his
there
work going on in there.
Right. I just wanted to make sure you knew in case, you know, because I didn't know.
But, you know, it's interesting.
Yes, yes.
But, you know, I've got to tell, well, that's just to make us, you know, miss Dave and his...
Yes.
Yeah, no, stuff that he likes to do. But you know what? If you go onto Alexander's website, you're going to see some reviews. And you think that maybe, you know, because he's our friend and he does our work that we can't say enough about him. Listen right here. And this is not us that's written it. I own a Cadillac Eldorado, and one of their mechanics is a Cadillac man. I can't say enough good. This is another one. I can't say enough good things about their service, prices, and integrity. Another one. All the guys here get it and what good old school customer service entails. That speaks volumes. That's the kind of care you're going to get at Alexander's All Care Auto Repair.
Absolutely. And in one place that you won't need a vehicle of any kind is in the jungle. And so let's
because the wheels get caught up in all of that flora and fauna.
Yes, but you'll just want to ride on the back of a big bear.
Well, especially if that big bear is Baloo, because Baloo is so big and lovable, so cutie.
And that's what Disney's counting on, so because that's why they have all the stuffed animals out there. But, of course, it did open yesterday, The Jungle Book, and this is a reimagining, just an adaptation, a live-action adaptation of the animated classic. Neil Setti plays an orphan boy who is raised in the jungle with the help of... Oh, nice, set the mood, Eric. He's raised in the jungle with the help of a pack of wolves, one of which is played by Lupita Nyong'o.
Are there wolves in the jungle?
Well, in this jungle there are. And a bear.
This is a jungle that represents every community.
Yes.
Of jungle.
And then there's a bear named Baloo, voiced by Bill Murray. And then there's a Black Panther, voiced by Ben Kingsley. Other voice talents include Idris Elba as the evil Shere Khan. Scarlett Johansson as the snake, right?
I get that.
And Christopher Walken as King Louie. What's the snake's name? I forget her name.
Hot, sexy girl.
Wow. Okay. Eric is attracted to snakes.
Now, see, just because he said that, now I cannot get her name.
Well, it was a male snake in the original.
I think. Yeah. I'm trying to remember. Oh, my gosh. I can't believe it. All I can remember is Shere Khan and Baloo.
We'll find it.
King Louie.
Director Jean... Why am I doing it like he's
Jean?
French. Jean Favreau, who brought us the original Iron Man, he brings the Jungle Book to life in a magical and breathtaking way that would make Walt Disney exceptionally proud. In our first segment, Trisha and I were talking a lot about Walt Disney and, you know, all the magic that he's brought to his parks and of course, all the movies that he's helped bring to life. And he would be so proud of this adaptation. It's one of the most memorable. It's an adaptation of one of the most memorable masterpieces from Disney's vault. We were talking about that vault earlier, how things go in there, and then they lead us to believe that they're not coming out. It pays enough homage to the classic to charm those who are familiar with it, while simultaneously reinventing it as a grand spectacle that wraps itself around you. You know, you need that action. You need that that little bit of violence in there. One, to update it for the new generation and to make it a little bit new for those who are, you know, you don't want just the same old story. You want a little bit changed, right?
You want to have a twist, yes.
Right. And then, of course, you also want to take full advantage of the technology, the big screen and the live action and everything. It truly transports you to its lavish setting. Favreau and company have gone above and beyond the bare necessities. Thanks, Eric. Using visual ingenuity to create an experience that is absolutely the next best thing to an actual trip to the jungle or alternatively a trip to Disneyland or Disney World. You know, so a lot of people are looking for that little bit cheaper experience than doing any of that. So you just go to the movie and, you know, get some popcorn and enjoy an hour and a half, 2 hours with Blue and Company.
So I don't understand. It's live action.
It's now the only live action actor. The only actor is Neil Setti, the Mowgli.
Is everything else computer CG?
Everything else is CG. It was all blue screen. They filmed on a set, blue screen, and the voice actors, Bill Murray and everything like that. They brought.
That's what I was wondering, because you kept saying live action, so I'm thinking, how is Bill Murray playing Baloo?
Right, right.
You should have seen him getting into that costume.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Is he wearing like a big fake bear suit?
Well, that's what's a little bit weird about this one is because you've got Cinderella. That's all live action. This is more live action in the sense that Roger Rabbit was live action, kind of.
I see.
You know, I mean, I guess the other way around. But
gotcha.
Right. I mean, so it's still live action in that it, you know, the boy is live, and I mean, so it's still somewhat animated, mostly animated, actually.
Okay, now we understand.
Yeah, but it is very much a spectacle. But they do keep it a PG rating. So I said that it's violent, but it's just, you know, you've got to have that.
So they didn't even make it PG-13. It's PG.
No, it's still PG.
So you can take the little ones, too.
Yes, but of course.
But violent, nonetheless.
Violent in terms that if a little one is scared with a tiger, you know, you. Jumping out at them and growling, of course, if you see it in 3D especially. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, if you see some of the behind-the-scenes featurettes, there's Jon Favreau in the water splashing the actor.
Oh, no.
Yeah, and so they did a lot of hands-on stuff like that. So, you know, he was working the puppet and stuff like that. Yeah.
Jon Favreau,
yeah.
I can do without him.
Okay, I'm sorry. Well, 4 stars for The Jungle Book. I really liked it. I would say that I still liked Cinderella better, though, because Cinderella is magical in a way that really, I mean, I felt like the cartoon, the animated movie was coming to life. This feels like an extension of the original.
Okay. Yeah, so. That makes sense. Well, that's because I think, like you said, there's just too much of this that can't be live action.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And I like that they had some of the music in the movie. If you get the soundtrack, you'll hear Bill Murray and Christopher Walken and Scarlett Johansson singing these songs.
Mm-hmm.
In the movie, Christopher Walken and Bill Murray sing a little portion of their songs in the movie.
Oh.
During the credits, you'll hear Scarlett Johansson, and you'll hear her a little bit later on as well in today's show. But she's just during the credits. So it's a really nice film, magical, plenty of action. If you don't have kids, I think that you're still going to get a really big kick out of it because it's feels like a blockbuster.
Mm.
It feels like it takes advantage of the big screen. I did not see it in 3D.
The surround sound and everything.
Yeah, I didn't see it in 3D, so I can't comment on that, but I tend to avoid 3D whenever possible.
Really?
Yeah, I don't care for 3D.
Really?
Yeah. The only time I ever liked 3D was, I think there's San Andreas was worth it in 3D, and Jurassic World was worth it in 3D.
Okay.
And Avatar and Tron. So I'd say 4 times.
I heard there's several sequels to Avatar coming.
Yeah, 4 of them. Yeah. Let's get one down. Well, let's get one more done, and then we can talk about the other 3.
And Scarlett's name is Ka.
Ka, yes. Yes, K-A-A, right?
Yes, exactly.
Very good. Yeah, I had all those toys from McDonald's when I was just a little lad. Yeah. So, and I don't know.
they didn't have toys in Happy Meals at McDonald's when I was a little lad.
No. And when Dave was a little lad, they didn't even have McDonald's. Okay. Well, on that note, let's.
Ronald McDonald was just a glimmer in the clown's eye.
Yeah, Ronald didn't come about until like the 70s, right?
I know. I'm teasing. Yeah. I think so.
Yeah.
Late 60s, early 70s.
And there's actually a movie about the Golden Arches that's coming out, the founder of McDonald's.
Ray Kroc.
It's called The Founder.
Wow.
It's not called Kroc.
No.
Those are the things that Mario Batali wears.
Yes, those are C-R-O-C, not K-R-O-K.
Oh, yeah. Those are shoes.
Those are shoes and a brand. But I will tell you, Joan Kroc, his wife, she's a huge philanthropist in San Diego area. She may have passed away just a few years ago, but
Are you thinking of Joan
Croc,
the San Diego Chargers owner? There was another Joan philanthropist.
We're talking Joan Croc, McDonald's fame.
I'm not sure.
You'll have to look her up and see if she's passed away. But even if she has, her estate gives a free entrance to kids to the San Diego Zoo. Oh. And she has, I mean, just the Joan Croc Foundation has just been incredible.
Yeah, she died in 03.
Okay. Oh, okay. Well, that was only 13 years ago. When you're old like me, 13 years can go like that. But see, that's when my kids were younger, and now they're 30, so that makes sense. Well, but she still does it through her foundation, even though she's passed.
She was 75.
And there are no Crocs in the Jungle Book, but there are in the jungle, which we're going to find out in our next segment with the jungle expert Jackie Witt. And what's
the difference between a crocodile and an alligator?
I don't know.
The snout.
Yes. Oh. Very good. Very good. Nice. Crocodiles have a very narrow, and alligators have a wide.
Wow.
Or opposite. Okay. I did opposite, didn't I?
I don't remember.
I think I just did opposite.
Well, you might be right. Crocs might have the thinner one.
Well, you were talking a little bit about being old like you.
Yes.
Right? Well, I want to be like you. Christopher Walken from The Jungle Book, the new one that opened up yesterday. I really liked Christopher Walken's version of this. He's a pretty good singer with this song. Man Cub.
He's an old song and dance man.
He is. And we'll hear more from him in our second hour. But I love how he does this, listen. I wanna be like you. And we'll be right back after this break in Christopher Walken's rendition of I Wanna Be Like You after these few minutes. Like someone like you.
Now don't try to kid me, man cub. I'll make a deal with you. I desire this man's red fire to make my dream come true. Now give me the secret, man cub. Come on, clue me what to do. Give me the power of man's red fire so I can be like you. Oh, Ooby-Doo, I wanna be like you. I wanna walk like you, talk like you too. You'll see it's true. Someone like me can learn to be like someone like you.
Are you suffering from back pain or joint problems? Is stress getting the best of you? Do you want to lose a few pounds? Try healing powers of hot yoga at Bikram Yoga Peoria. Hot yoga is therapeutic, restorative, and rejuvenating. Bikram Yoga Peoria is offering 90-minute hot yoga classes. Mention Breakthrough Thinking to receive one complimentary class, one free healthy meal protein shake, and one free wellness assessment. Benefits of hot yoga include reducing high cholesterol, reducing high sugar, improving flexibility, endurance, energy, and strength, improving metabolism, and burning fat. What are you waiting for? Pick up the phone and call now to claim your free ticket to change your life. 623-486-3843. Mention Breakthrough Thinking. That's 623-486-3843. And online, BikramYogaPeoria.com. That's B-I-K-R-A-M, YogaPeoria.com.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Beerenbaum and Spien PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you.
communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Birenbaum and Spien works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
Trust in me, just in me. Still plays. You can sleep safe and sound.
Welcome back to Breakthrough Entertainment right here on KPHX 1480 AM. Brought to you by the Breakthrough Thinking Broadcasting Network. We're live in Phoenix. I am Joseph J. Erdo next to Trisha and Eric Reinert.
Wait a minute, your eyes are spinning around and
yes.
around. They're so hypnotic.
There's a reason for that, because I want you to go see The Jungle Book.
Is this Scarlett Johansson?
No, not this version. The next
one.
No,
this is the old one. This is the male Ka.
Yeah, from the original Trust in Me, Ka, singing, oh, yeah. All right. Well, in just a moment, we're going to have on a really special guest, but we want to remind our listeners that this hour is brought to you by Alexander's All Care Automotive. Right, Trisha?
Yes. Alexander's All Care Automotive is the best place to take your car, whether it's something simple like changing a light bulb like we talked about, or something major where you just don't know what's going on and the computer is just telling you check engine, right? So my car just stopped. It just stopped.
Uh-oh.
It was running fine and everything, and I left it running with the AC going while I ran into a store. And
you got
to
put gas.
Somebody
in
was in the car. No. It was not the gas tank. It was actually the fuel filter, because it acted like it was out of gas, but it's the fuel filter. And the heat from the – it's a California car, and
was
I brought
it
to Arizona. Yes. And I didn't know that that was something that needs to be taken care of. In the car. So, yeah. So, I learned, and he took good care of me, got me back on the road the very next day.
Take it over to 3310 East Thomas Road. That's in Phoenix. Call 602-956-3781. 602-956-3781.
And tell him Dave and Trisha Isaac sent you.
Excellent.
Or Breakthrough Entertainment.
Absolutely. And, of course, now I'm very excited because we get to learn a little bit more about the jungle, the real jungle, from an expert, Jackie Witt, with Adios Adventure Travel. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning. Hi, everybody.
Good morning.
Hi. All right. So, you know, first of all, let's get this out of the way. I just gave The Jungle Book 4 stars. Have you gotten a chance to see the new film yet?
Well, it just opened yesterday, and although I did look and try, I could not find a place to see it locally. So I went and refreshed my memory from some of my childhood videos and movies.
Okay, excellent.
By the way, Joseph, you gave it 4 stars. Online, it has 4.5.
Yeah, but four is our max.
Yeah, 4.
Oh, I see.
Well, no, 5 is our max. 5 is our max.
It keeps changing, Trisha.
No, 5 is our max. I've given things 5. 5 is a breakthrough.
Oh. Yeah. For some reason, I thought, we just changed our rating scale. Sorry about that, Jackie. I didn't
That's
know.
That's
we
used to, for me.
Because it used to drive
I'm
me crazy. I couldn't get
jungle.
Middle of the road. Oh, yes. Well, I'm interested to find out about you.
Yeah. So tell us a little bit about Adios Adventure Travel.
Well, we're a small tour operators, and I run the U.S. office. My business partner is a Quechua man from Peru. And together we create itineraries and travel trips for people that want to go explore in South America.
Excellent, excellent. And so, now I know you've been to several different jungles. And when we talk about the Jungle Book, what would you say would be the jungle that brings to mind for you? What would you say that jungle is?
Well, that jungle has tigers in it, and it seems to be a mixture of African and Asian settings.
Yeah, I said it was probably an all-inclusive.
Yeah, the South American jungle, you don't find tigers, but you do find cats, medium-sized cats like pumas and jaguars.
And Eric earlier was saying, you know, are there wolves in the jungle?
No.
No, there aren't, right?
No, there are not.
Okay, just in Walt Disney's imagination.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, and so what would you say your favorite jungle to visit personally that you've been to and why?
Well, I've been to three different types of jungle, I would say. One was a riverboat cruise in Ecuador.
Disneyland.
On a very small riverboat, which is a very good option for families who want to explore and have a little bit of comfort. You have air-conditioned cabins and, you know, a private bathroom with hot water. Mm-hmm. The other way to go is in Peru, to where you fly to the jungle and transfer to a lodge. But my favorite was the one I did most recently, was an expedition overland for 10 hours. After I flew to Cusco in the mountains, I traveled 10 hours by car and then 10 hours by canoe.
Wow.
To Casa Machiguenga in the Manu Biosphere Reserve. On the Peru-Brazil border.
Wow.
Yeah,
and that's
one
of the most
region.
Remote places on the planet. There's very little development there, and that's the place where when you hear about uncontacted tribes of human beings, that's where they live.
And did you eat monkey brains?
Well, no, that's probably a myth.
No, my ex-husband's from Peru. And he went there with a school group in high school, and they ate with the tribes, and they ate monkey brains.
Wow. Well, a lot of people will try the guinea pig.
Oh yeah, cuy.
That's higher. Yeah, cuy up in the mountains. And I've tried that. It, you know, everybody says it tastes like chicken. One of the probably the most eaten foods is the yucca and the bananas, the plantains, they call them.
Mm-hmm.
That's very popular and easy to come by in the jungle.
Now, of course, the song, you eat the fancy ants in the bare necessities. Have you ever eaten the fancy ants or anything like that?
Well, as a matter of fact, on the last trip, I did try a termite.
Oh, okay. And how did that taste?
It was a little nutty.
Okay.
Sounds very unsatisfying.
You have to really eat a lot. You have to eat a lot to really get the flavor, and I just sampled a couple.
Okay, that makes sense. That makes sense.
But they supposedly are very high in protein.
That's exactly right.
Yeah, we had some crickets in here 2 weeks ago for our April Fool's show, and we really did.
Yeah.
Or I ate them. And
well, from Endomarket, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's actually one of the trendy diets now is eating bugs, like worm tacos and stuff.
Yeah, yeah. And so if, in case anyone is just now joining us, we are speaking with Jackie Witt on behalf of Adios Adventure Travel. She's telling us a little bit about the jungle in celebration of yesterday's release of The Jungle Book. I gave it 4 stars. It's a great film. And I know that everyone's going to be wanting to experience this, you know, the jungles. I think it's going to make people interested in going to jungles and in having these experiences. So that's like a once-in-a-lifetime type of thing for a lot of people, no?
Yes, it is. And ecotourism is one way to help save the jungle because there's a collision now of interest occurring in the Amazon jungle as well as other places on the planet. Oil development, gold mining, building highways, those are all having an impact on the disappearing of the jungle. But there are things that help the jungle, and ecotourism is one of those because it's incentive to preserve the jungle in its natural state.
You mentioned medium-sized cats in the jungle. You said puma, and what else is there?
A jaguar.
Would you consider those, medium-sized cat to me is not like a tiger or a lion. Are they dangerous animals?
Yeah, they're solo animals. They travel alone, usually at night. And to spot one is a special happening. I recently spotted my very first ever puma. But it wasn't in the jungle. It was in kind of the mid.
The zoo?
Yeah. Yeah, it was in actually in Patagonia. I was in Chile last month, and I saw one in kind of a savanna plains. It wasn't quite jungle, but it was hunting. And I've looked and looked and looked for a jaguar in the jungle. I'd love to see one, but it's not common to spot a cat because of their nighttime prowling and because they're loners. And they shy away from people.
I was going to say, I'm sure they've seen you, but you just haven't seen them.
Exactly. I got up one night in a lodge and walked to the bathroom, and all the way there, I just thought to myself, boy, I wonder who's watching me right now.
So they wouldn't attack.
Well, you know, probably not. But you still have, you know, this imagination that kicks in, especially when it's dark outside and you're alone and, you know, you're in a place where these animals live. It's their home and you're a visitor. So you don't really know what they're capable of.
Now, I noticed that you have a lot of tours, like to Machu Picchu, out of Cusco, and the like. Is that where the majority of your tours go, or you're mentioning Chile and Patagonia?
Yeah, I would say the majority of people want to go to Machu Picchu. And what people are doing now is they're combining Machu Picchu with other destinations. And it is possible to combine Machu Picchu with a trip to the jungle, to the Amazon jungle.
Excellent. And I know a lot of people are interested in going to Havasupai and those here in Arizona. Do you have tours there as well?
No, we're specialists. We just specialize in South America.
Okay. Excellent. Good to know. And, you know, in the new Jungle Book, they've made King Louie and Ka really, really big. There's a really big snake and the really big, what is that, Giganticus or whatever, the monkey, whatever it is.
I thought he was an orangutan.
Well, in the new one, he's really, really big. I mean, so what would you say the biggest animal that you've encountered in the jungle has been?
Well, aside from the puma, which wasn't in the jungle, it was in Patagonia, I have seen howler monkeys, and they're a pretty good size, but they live in the top canopy of the trees, so you don't see them up really close. But you do try to avoid the junk they throw down from the top of the tree, because that's their way of, you know, telling you, go away, when they see you. They like to throw things down. So they're probably one of the biggest, except for the marine or the water animals. I have seen the pink dolphins, and they're pretty big. But they're not as active as the dolphins we know in the ocean off the Pacific or the Atlantic coast, the blue and the gray dolphins. The pink dolphins are live a little more underwater. They don't leap out of the water, and usually the water is murky, so they're not as visible. So that's something that people don't realize about when you visit the jungle. It's really important to have remind yourself that you're not in a zoo. You can't guarantee you're going to see a certain animal, and the animals are not going to always be as visible as they are in a zoo. You might see an animal, but it might be shrouded by leaf cover. So you just have to remember that you're in the animal's natural habitat, not in a zoo.
Right.
But, you know, there is something to be said when you do get a glimpse of an animal out in the actual jungle and you see them, or somebody points them out and you get them. It's like, wow, you know, it's exciting. You know, I remember even little bats that were on the pilings of a small bridge that we were going under with our boat. And, you know, if you didn't know what you were looking for, you wouldn't have even seen them, you know.
Exactly. So. And that's where having a really good guide is important.
Yes.
So that's one thing I would recommend is to, you know, if people are interested in traveling, is to make sure you retain good guide service, because the guides know the habitats, they know the behaviors of the animals, and they're going to help you spot them and see them and know what the safety rules are too.
And Jackie, where can we find you? Where can we find it? Adios Adventure Travel online?
Well, you can just go to the website, and if you go to Google and type in the word Adios Adventure Travel, you should be able to find us. Our office is in Virginia, in the U.S., and we have an office in Cusco in Peru.
Excellent. Excellent. Well, Jackie, thank you so much for joining us today.
Yes, and maybe I'll see you out on the Inca Trail. That's one of my...
I
love Cusco and Machu Picchu. I really, really, really... The whole Enchanted Valley area is gorgeous.
It is, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Jackie. Take care.
Adios.
And Eric, now calm down, Eric. Calm down.
This is Scarlett.
Scarlett Johansson as Ka, singing Trust in Me. If you looked into Scarlett Johansson's eyes, what would you do, Eric?
I don't know. I was going to say something, but I'm not going to say
it. I tell you, do anything she said. You know what? They should call her Campfire, because... All right, well, we'll be right back after this break.
It's now time for the word association game. Contestants, go ahead.
Bars. Meat market. Gas.
High prices.
Politicians.
Liars.
Auto mechanics.
Ripoff. Guys, whoa, 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 wait a minute here. Now, when I think of my auto mechanic, I think of trust, care, safety, and fairness. This sounds like the definition of a friend, which was what Alexander's All Care Automotive Repair achieves with his customers. The peace of mind that comes with the mechanic that puts you first. Located at 3310 East Thomas Road, Phoenix, 85018. Call 602-956-3781. 602-956-3781.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Beerenbaum and Spien PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you. Communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Beerenbaum and Spien works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
This is 1480 KPHX.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities.
Yeah, man. This is Breakthrough Entertainment Jungle Book Show right here on KPHX 1480 AM live in Phoenix, Arizona. Brought to you by the Breakthrough Thinking Broadcasting Network. And this is another version of the Bare Necessities from the Jungle Book 2.
How many are there?
There's several. You'll hear at least two more. But the bees are buzzing in the trees.
He's a little bit obsessed with the Bare Necessities of life.
I am. John Goodman and Haley Joel Osment singing this one, so you know their voices.
Oh, yeah.
All right. And
John Goodman's voice, but not Haley Joel.
You don't say...
Haley Joel Osment?
Oh, he's like 30 now, isn't he?
Yeah. He's a really good actor, though. When you pick a raw paw. Okay. All right. Well, we can transition out of that because the Jungle Book is not the only movie that opened up yesterday. There's another one. There's several others, but another one that I'm really excited about. I got a chance to see it. 13 Cameras is what it's called. And
I was too scared to see it. I'm sorry, but I really was. I was too scared to see it.
Oh, well, and I think that some of that scare comes from our next guest, actor Neville Archambault. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hey, thank you.
Hey, you know,
hello, Phoenix.
Yay!
Hey,
you know,
and thank you for getting my last name right.
Oh, you're
that's nice.
That's all because of me.
Yeah, that was Eric's doing.
You checked up on that one first. That's good. It was good. No one ever gets it right, but I appreciate that. Thanks, man.
No, and we really appreciate you being here. And this, I mean, I'm hoping this is taken as a compliment, but dude, you are scary.
He doesn't sound scary.
He doesn't right now.
How's that? No.
Oh, no. So that's better.
So you saw the film, I guess.
Yes, I did. I mean,
or you just saw a picture.
No, I don't. Well, yeah, the picture alone. I mean, that is really creepy. But you really made this movie for me.
Thank you.
I mean, it's available on video on demand. It's also playing at AMC Arizona Arizona Center, I believe. PJ McCabe and Brianne
Monacreft
play newlyweds who move into a new home, having no ideas that their landlord, that's you, has installed secret cameras in it. They soon find out that their marital issues are nothing in comparison to the monster that watches their every move. You know, what was the audition process like for this? Because, I mean, again, you really fit the bill of this really creepy voyeur guy.
Well, again, thanks. No, how do you say it? I appreciate that. No. you know, actually, they saw my actor's reel. Mm-hmm. And, you know, which, of course, as you know, it's a little clip of different movies you've done and like. And so they saw it and decided to have me in, the McManus brothers, who also did Funeral Kings. I don't know if you've seen Funeral Kings, but if you get a chance, definitely see it. It's a great film. But they saw me, and they decided to bring me in. And I was lucky because I got a script for about 5 days before casting. And I saw a couple key words in there, and one was slackjaw. And from there, I really just built the character. Mm-hmm. And I came in, and you know, I did kind of this. And it just flew. And then I ended up really loving, well, of course, I love the script because it's very much like Hitchcock. So it's not like films or thrillers or horrors today, which are a lot of script that's so well done and was really easy to do. But building the character was really, really kind of a delight. I liked it.
Excellent.
Well, now, see, I actually love you as an actor, and I really wanted to watch this film, but I also was scared of it. But I loved you on Law & Order SVU.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, I mean, and so when I heard it was you that we were having on, I was all excited, and then I felt really bad that I hadn't seen 13 Cameras. But thrillers kind of scare me a little bit.
Yeah, no, you know, I can understand that. And, yeah, I definitely can understand that. But in this, you know, it's interesting. My character, Gerald, in a crazy way, I think people sort of feel for him. Because I know he's out there doing crazy things, but there's a side of him that's he's good because he's wanting to, you know, in his crazy mixed up way, he's wanting to do something good for Claire, who's has this terrible relationship with her husband, who's really doing some, you know, rotten stuff behind her back. So in his simple way, he's trying to do good. So when you see the film, you kind of go, you know, it's kind of like, oh, it's interesting. It's funny. Because there's a part of him that's funny, but very scary.
Well, and the voice is scary, you know, but the look just it had me. I mean, I think that's the strongest asset of the film. That's you. I mean, your mannerisms and your facial expressions alone disturbed me beyond belief. I mean, is there any makeup involved? I mean, how did they get that look?
Well, you know, it's something that I have within. I just sort of turn it on. But they've used, you know, some makeup and some age stuff, you know, age makeup and, mm-hmm. and a little bit. But pretty much a lot of that I just get from within. Mm-hmm. And I just pour it out. And I think I did it, like I said, really just from a few key words, and I build on that. And I get the stare, and I get the stare, and I just stare, and I never blink.
Yeah, yeah, and that's what, I mean, your mouth is, your jaw's hanging open, and you're
right.
Just looking at that screen. I mean, we see the reflection in your glasses, and just the look in your eyes. I mean, you're so just absorbed by what you're seeing.
Yeah, I do get absorbed, and not to sound, you know, cliche or goofy or, you know, actors, well, I did this, but it really was about that script, because mm-hmm. the script is so good, and what was taking place in it with, you know, with her. And then I just put myself in the position of this person who, Gerald, and it just flew from there, really. And it's just feeling what someone like he with that mentality would feel mm-hmm. or do, you know, somebody that's so lonely and trapped,
so there
know,
was,
in their own,
there
own
was...
private world. And all he does, he has these, you know, these rental apartments and houses, and he, you know, it's his own little world. He does nothing but see other people in and out of his life, and he's lonely, you know. And I think that, and you know, the actually scariest thing about the movie to me is that with technology the way it is now today, this could be really a reality, and it is a reality. And I've gone on, and anyone can go online, and you can read about it, where people do this. And I don't know if you guys seen, there's that one YouTube thing where there's somebody living in somebody's wall, and they come out at night and feed from the refrigerator.
Wow.
You know, they actually tape this person. They found, but there's stuff like that, and it actually goes on. But with technology, what we have today, you can do anything. You can spy anyone. You can stand in a corner. You can be anywhere. You're coming out of the gym or coming out of the store. And if you ask yourself, am I being watched? Yes, you are. There's a camera. There's a camera on that pole. There's a camera in the store. You're being watched everywhere you are. But now we're so far advanced, you can be watching your own home.
Well, I think that's what I was going to say, is that there are a lot of people out there. That's what's so scary about this movie. There are a lot of people out there. There are a lot of Geralds out there.
Yeah, there are.
I mean, and a lot of them have the drones nowadays, too.
Yeah, which is even scarier.
Well, I'm wondering, I mean, there's yeah, we all have, like, I know my daughter has a little camera that's in her living room so that she can watch her pets when she's not there on her phone.
Right.
You know?
People hack into those. They
but
hack
that's
into
what
the baby
monitors. I was thinking, they could hack
into
it and could see it, and then they don't have to go in and wire your place. But
yeah, go ahead, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say, because I didn't see the movie, I read up on it as best as I could, and you were talking about the script. Now, I will say, from what I've been reading, it really truly is your performance as well that brings that script so phenomenally effective.
I agree.
But
yeah, well, thank you.
Evidently, this story was written by Viktor Zarkov, who also directed this.
Yes. Uh huh.
Wow. Yeah. So how was that? Was he leaning kind of on you, or?
Well, never necessarily leaned on me. Actually, it kind of was a group effort with Kevin and Matt McManus, the two brothers who are excellent, talented, incredible guys. We all, it was, you know, that, well, of course, films was, most films are always a joint, you know, venture, but this, you know, more so working with them. And I did get a lot of ideas or thoughts or freedom, and I should say, because the set was really a set that was without ego. A lot of sets in Hollywood or, you know, films have big egos or directors that have egos. And ultimately, a lot of times it just ruins the production because there's too much power from one individual. So no one expresses freedom and allows, for example, an actor, I was allowed to do what I wanted in this film or to go ahead and then go back. And, you know, we go back, okay, don't like it, let's try it again. And so there's, and of course it happens in films, but in this there was extra freedom because everyone's accessible. So I think for Gerald, that's what the success of it was, because I was able to really work and, you know, allowed to express myself.
If anyone is just now joining us, we are speaking with actor Neville Archambault on behalf of the new film 13 Cameras, available on video on demand, also at select movie theaters across the country, including here at the Arizona Center. You're definitely going to want to see this movie. I'm giving it 3 stars. I think it is your performance. I mean, the movie itself is fantastic, but your performance is just worth seeing in and of itself. And then you've got to see that poster with you with the duct tape. You know, do you have one of those posters at home now?
Yes, I do.
Good for you.
doesn't scare visitors, does it?
it's on my wall. It's kind of got a little shroud. I have one on my wall, actually. The new one. That's the new one. Yeah, right. I really like that poster.
Yeah, yeah, and of course you had the festival circuit, and it was going around under the name Slumlord, right?
It was Slumlord, which was went everywhere. Went to London and won awards in London and Montreal and Los Angeles, actually at Brahms Chinese.
Wow!
So which was nice, but yeah, it was on Slumlord, and it's only been about I think the last month or so that we've been 13 cameras.
Wow! Wow! Yeah, again, you've got to see this movie.
Well, now, see, and the 13 cameras, I think, at least for me, from what I know about it, I think that's an even better title.
Yeah, I like the name.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people complained about it being Slumlord because they said, well, it's such a nice apartment. It's such a nice place.
It's not a slum,
well,
yeah.
It was, you know, it was about Gerald, him, the, mm-hmm. you know, he was a slumlord. But, you know, slumlord worked, but 13 cameras, kind of speaks to everyone, I think.
Yes.
Everyone understands it.
Yeah. And as scary as you are, I mean, I have to compliment you. Well, you know, as scary as his
you
character
are as this character.
Yeah, as this
okay,
character.
Because he seems like a pretty nice guy.
Yeah, he is a very nice guy.
No, but, really, I am a nice guy.
Hey, get off my car.
But, you know, you're really built, too. I mean, you've got muscles, right?
Well, you know, yeah, I've been an addict my whole life, yeah. I've been kind of a little bit of a I've been a fitness addict. Well, an addict, I am, which I am. I was, and not really necessarily a stereotypical muscle thing, but it's just been a fitness thing for me, and something I live by and do every day. So it's just part of my life and something I really enjoy.
Now, I think you would scare me if I saw you doing the haka. You know, right? I mean, now you're also New Zealand.
Well, my mother's New Zealander.
Wow.
From Auckland, New Zealand, and so I have a dual citizenship with New Zealand.
That's pretty cool.
But I'm basically a gringo.
Well, you sound like a gringo. You don't
Is that
sound
what
like
they
you're
call,
from New Zealand.
Is that what they call us over in New Zealand?
What's that?
The gringos, is that what they call us in New Zealand?
No,
that's
actually,
a Southern California
Mexico,
word.
I lived a long time in Mexico, actually in the state of Guerrero for a long time, so sometimes I use that expression, gringo. But I worked down in Mexico, and I did some work in television down there and ran a business down there for a while.
Wow.
Very cool.
There's a little part of me that's Mexican.
And Neville,
my brothers.
Ah.
Oh, okay. Well, what else do you have coming out, aside from 13 cameras?
Well, you know what? When I'm really, well, I'm actually, my phone's been ringing, so I have a couple things that I've been, you know, I'm reading for. So I won't jinx anything, but it's more on the lines of film work. But what I would really hope for, because aside from just being this being a thriller, which you should say just, I just think it has a real good message in the sense of what we've been talking about with technology and I don't know. There's a part of me that there's something we really need to be a little bit careful with because it's gotten so loose and you say like drones and everything. It's, I don't know. There's a part of me, like I said, I think it gives a little bit of a message. But I would hope to do the sequel of mm-hmm. 13 cameras.
Oh, I think Ooh. That would be excellent.
And there's talk about it. So, and as you saw it, so you can see where the ending. And how'd you like the ending?
I love the ending.
Me too.
Yeah,
I did. Me too.
I don't want to reveal it. I don't want to reveal it.
Of course, we can't.
But it's surprised,
it just,
right?
It's a surprise, and it's just it was interesting.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And I mean, you've also got the familial, you know, the family drama and everything like that. So there's other great things about it. And you know, in my review, I say how, you know, I love all these movies where they make particular places really scary. I mean, Jaws did it, made it impossible to go swimming in the ocean. Frozen, not the animated film, but the horror film, made many people think twice about boarding a ski lift. 13 cameras makes you uneasy even being in your own home. It sends chills down your spine, creates within you a paranoia about ominous observers that lingers long after the end credits have rolled, especially because of that ending. I have to thank you so much for this performance. I think you're right up there with the best of the baddies, you know?
Thank you. And that was excellently what you just read. That was excellent.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good. Yeah.
And just so our listeners know, I looked up the show times, and 1 p.m. So today, after the show, today's show ends at noon. You're going to want to check it out at 1 p.m. or 3:10 p.m. or 6:40 p.m. At AMC Arizona Center 24 here in Phoenix. Or you can check it out on video on demand. But there's got to be a great thing about seeing this on the big screen and seeing your face larger than life, that really creepy expression on your face.
I couldn't agree more. I saw it in New York last night, and well, here in New York is where I am right now.
Mm-hmm.
And you're right. It's great to see it on the big screen.
Absolutely. Well, again, actor Neville Archambault, thank you so much for joining us. We look forward to talking with you again very soon.
Okay, anytime. And thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Well,
we appreciate
thank it you, and keep up the phenomenal body of work.
Don't be scared.
Oh, no. You know, actually, it was mostly because I was going to have to watch it at night by myself.
Oh.
So I think if I can watch it with my husband, I think I would enjoy it very much, because yeah. I do like that type of a movie that is mystery and suspense and that kind of a thriller. Mm-hmm. And I love your acting. So I really do want to see it. I just didn't want to see it by myself at
thank
night.
You. Thank you so much. I appreciate that so much. I really do.
Yeah, just get yourself get some fast food and, you know, like Gerald likes to do, and, you know, enjoy.
And
yeah,
watch.
Cheese, but...
And get some chains, the kind yeah. that keeps the greyhound.
Okay, you guys, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank
Take
you
care.
For joining
you
us.
You have a good day.
You
all
too.
Right.
You too. Yes, again,
He's a phenomenal actor, isn't he?
And I was telling Eric as we walked into the studio, I was saying, Eric, you gotta see this movie, because I know Eric likes a lot of these horrors and
I'll thrillers. Watch it.
Yes. So I think you really get a kick out of it.
I'll watch it tonight. How's that?
Excellent. And I hope that a lot of our listeners do the same. Again, a big thank you to actor Neville Archambault. 13 Cameras is the name of the movie. Go and see this movie. So we've got another special guest coming up after the break, but we need to hear another version of I Wanna Be Like You.
He's already called, by the way. I told him to call back.
I like it.
Well, Smash Mouth brings us this one, I Wanna Be Like You, from Jungle Book 2.
Now I'm
oh, yeah. Like that?
Yeah.
VIP. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
But I like Smash Mouth, so.
Yeah. Yeah, and ooby-doo. Yeah. All right. And don't run into any man cubs either. So Breakthrough Entertainment will be right back after Smash Mouth brings us into our break. These few minutes brought to you by the Breakthrough Thinking Broadcasting Network. Right back on KPHX 1480 AM.
It's now time for the word association game. Contestants, go ahead.
Bars. Meat market. Gas.
High prices.
Politicians.
Liars.
Auto mechanics.
Ripoff. Guys, whoa, 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 wait a minute here. Not when I think of my auto mechanic, I think of trust, care, safety, and fairness. This sounds like the definition of a friend, which was what Alexander's All Care Automotive Repair achieves with his customers. The peace of mind that comes with the mechanic that puts you first. Located at 3310 East Thomas Road, Phoenix, 85018. Call 602-956-3781. 602-956-3781.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty.
uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Beerenbaum and Spean PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you. Communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Beerenbaum and Spean works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
We're your friends to the bitter end.
The bitter end.
When you're alone,
who comes around?
Welcome back to Breakthrough Entertainment right here on KPHX 1480 AM. We are live in Phoenix, brought to you by the Breakthrough Thinking Broadcasting Network. This is That's What Friends Are For from The Jungle Book. Of course, the vultures or whatever they are, right, in The Jungle Book. From the original version of that. But of course, this segment...
Oh, my gosh, yes, is brought to us by Quinn Schoenwald. And let me tell you, I need Quinn right now because just talking about that thriller has got me so tied up in knots. And Quinn is a licensed sports massage therapist who works at the world-renowned Fisher Institute. And whether you're in need of performance training or rehab and PT, give Quinn a call at 307-921-2684 because this man has magic hands.
Nice.
Well-trained magic hands.
Very good. And of course, the Jungle Book is not the only new release. As we heard, 13 Cameras, last segment. Great film.
Scary stuff.
We were still talking about it during the break. And there's another good thriller out as well. This one's a little more historical-based. And we've got on a really special guest, co-writer and director Florian Gallenberger. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hello. How are you?
Great. The movie's called Colonia, and I've got to say, right off the bat, I really like this movie.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Yeah, it's, you know, Emma Watson plays a young woman whose desperate search for her abducted boyfriend, played by Daniel Brühl, draws her into the infamous Colonia Dignidad. Tell us a little bit about, for our listeners who don't know about Colonia Dignidad, what was that?
Well, it's a German religious cult that was founded in Chile in 1961, and the cult actually cooperated very strongly with the secret police of Augusto Pinochet, who came to power in Chile in 1973, and political prisoners were taken to an underground torture camp underneath this Christian German cult and were tortured and killed there. And that's a true story, and it has never been really dealt with. It has never been really investigated. And so the idea behind the film was to bring that story to the knowledge of the audience and to tell people about what has really been happening in Chile at that time.
Excellent. And has anything come out of it so far? You know, because I mean, it's been out there. I know you released in some other countries, right?
Well, we did release in Germany. The film's just playing the theaters right now in Germany. And I have to say, yes, the film did make a change because the German Ministry of Foreign Affairs just stated last week that they are going to open the archives of what has been happening in Chile and that they need to investigate because also the German embassy was covering up for this cult and has been protecting them for many years. And now suddenly, and after the film has been screened, the German Minister of Foreign Affairs decided that they are going to change their attitude towards what happened, and they want to really find out. And if somebody made a mistake, or if somebody is guilty, they want to prosecute him and all that. And I think that's a great success for the movie.
Yeah, definitely is. I mean, because when we in our first hour, we were talking a little bit about it, and you know that we hadn't heard of this before the film,
right.
And you know now it's such a creepy story, a very thrilling story that you've brought to it. We'll talk about that in just a moment, and then this guy that Michael Nyquist plays,
right?
You know, what's his name again? The real
Paul Schaefer.
Paul Schaefer.
He was the leader of the cult. Yeah, he's a real character, mm-hmm. And I think Michael just gave a stunning performance of this really very dark and malicious person, you know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, in my review, I say he's one powerfully frightening villain. You know, what a despicable bad guy. He gets you all riled up, and, you know, so yeah, he just nails this character.
Yeah, it was interesting because I think it's really it really takes a lot of energy and braveness of an actor to open up to the darkness of such a character. Mm-hmm. And I remember those days that we were shooting like intensive scenes. Michael was completely exhausted afterwards, like running a marathon or something. Mm-hmm. So he really jumped into that darkness, and he said, "Well, if I want to play this character right, I have to discover my own darkness and really venture into the darkest places of my own psyche in order to not just pretend or not just make it like you know, some kind of a game, but really give it a feel of reality."
Yeah, he does an excellent job. And Tricia, you had something.
Well, now, so I just want to be clear. So when Michael Nyquist, when Paul Schaefer,
right,
died.
Uh-huh.
Did this cult go with him? Is this something that Chile is still dealing with? Because I've been to Chile and I'd never heard of Colonia Dignidad.
Well, I think if you ask in Chile, like, everybody is going to know that. It has been, the Colonia has been really a big player within Chile for 40 years, and it still exists. It exists still today. You know, for the movie, I went with Emma to the real cult so that she would see the people, that she would talk to the people and also, you know, understand that this is not just some kind of a story, but this is a part of reality. And Chile actually has been dealing much better with what happened there than Germany, because they had a big investigation concerning the political prisoners who were tortured within the Colonia. So Chile has been doing its own work and looking at its own past in this case.
So you say that Emma went there?
Yeah, Emma and I, we went there like 3 weeks before the shoot because I really wanted her to get the feel of the place, because the place is very distinct. It feels like completely like fallen out of time. The people, you know, are very, very peculiar, mm-hmm. because they have lived like for 40 years completely, you know, cut off from the rest of the world. Of course, the cult today is not like it was in the 70s, and that's the time that the film shows, mm-hmm. but it's still a very, very strange place. And I know that, you know, this showed Emma that the, you know, the story has, you know, a whole different dimension to it than just being a thriller.
Yeah, and she did a great job in the film as well, Emma Watson. I have to say that, you know, just an excellent performance. I mean, we were, you know, who knew she was back then in Harry Potter and all that, and now she's
right.
This tremendous actress.
Right.
And of course, go ahead, sorry.
I think it's, you know, it's interesting because the first part where she plays a grown-up woman, not a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that was something like everybody was really curious and looking forward to see her in this different type of character. And I think she did a good job. Yeah, great job.
And I think a lot of people like this about the film is that, you know, for a change, it's not the damsel in distress. I mean, she's going
right.
to help the guy.
Yeah, I think that was very important for her. Also, if you look at her, you know, a female empowerment, he for she campaign that she does for the United Nations, I think that was one aspect of the character that was important for her when she accepted the part, that it's the girl or it's the princess who goes to save the prince and not like normally the other way around. And she's a, you know, she's a brave character, but still fragile. And that was something that was important for me, that is someone who's fragile on the outside, but has a lot of inner conviction. Yeah. And I think that's what Emma is like 100%. She really, you know, fights for the things that she believes in, and she dedicates herself to what she thinks is important. And I think that was exactly that what she could bring into the part.
Well, and I think it's kind of cool that she was a flight attendant, because as somebody who's been in the travel industry for many, many, many years, flight attendants get a bad rap sometimes, and they're looked at as airheads and you know, just pretty little Barbies walking down the aisle. And I think seeing someone, you know, who is beautiful like she is, but is also smart and savvy and brave.
Right.
I think that's wonderful to be able to see that as well. So I think I appreciate that.
Isn't that something that was different in the 70s, the way how people looked at flight attendants?
Yeah.
Because I think then, you know, it was considered a very attractive job. And, you know, so maybe that has changed within the last 20, 30 years.
Well, you would think so, but you'd be amazed when people get a few drinks in them, what they think they can do with a flight attendant, you know, that just because, that's unfortunately, the stereotype still exists. Not quite as strongly, but it still exists.
It's generally amazing what a couple of drinks can do to people. So.
For sure, especially when you're all locked up in a little metal tube flying at 10,000 feet.
Well, yeah, these days, it takes an hour to get a drink, so I don't know how you can get drunk on a plane.
Well, if anyone's just now joining us, we are speaking with co-writer and director Florian Gallenberger on behalf of the new film Colonia. It opened up yesterday. It's exclusively here at in Phoenix at the Harkins Shea. And I think it's also on video on demand, right?
Yes, of course. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so two ways to see it. I think you got to see this on the big screen, because I wanted to touch on this. You know, some critics are calling the film out, saying that it's not very, you know, significant in terms of historical value.
What?
I think that they're looking for something dry. And there's a lot of critics who like that dry feeling.
Right.
What I really loved about this film is that it's not dry. It is thrilling. It is very entertaining. And, I mean, I can't tell you how many movies I've seen that I've just, like, wanted to turn off or I fall asleep during, because they're trying to go buy the book, the history book, and they forget the entertainment value. So how important was that entertainment value for you, Florian?
Well, I'm glad you're bringing this up, because, you know, I always wanted to make a film that doesn't feel like a history lesson in school, but that's, you know, a cinematic experience and that's thrilling and that is entertaining. But for a lot of critics, this sort of, it's like it's forbidden to do something entertaining and at the same time look at a true story, at a historical true background. And I have to say I'm almost angry about that, because, you know, why can't something be a good ride and at the same time you find out about history? And I think for a lot of people, in the end of the film, and they realize it's a true story, because the pictures of the real Colonia Dignidad and its real inhabitants, I think that is an enriching moment for the audience, because they realize that something that they took just as a film is actually more. And I don't see any problem with that. And I completely agree with what you say. Our aim, our target was always to make a thrilling film. And if somebody does not care about the background, he would have still seen a thrilling film and, you know, had a good time in the theater.
Yeah, I mean, because, and I touch on that briefly in my review, that, you know, some people, you know, might discount the film because of that. And I think that, initially, when I was pitched this film, I looked and I was like, oh, Emma Watson, I've got to see this movie. But when I looked at it, and I was like, oh, a historical film, I've seen so many of those.
Right.
I don't know if I want to cover that, because so many filmmakers have kind of like burned me on that.
But this feels like a really great feature film.
Oh, yeah.
Not like it's documentary at all.
Right.
It really has a different feel.
Well, that's what I told Tricia right before this segment. I said I was so surprised with this film. You know, it blew me away how entertaining this was. And I mean, we were talking about all the, you know, the performers being very talented, but, you know, you do a great job. And, you know,
Thank you.
Some tremendous tension. You kept me on the edge of my seat for the entire runtime. The level of suspense, you know, my nerves were unable to escape this movie.
Well, that's great to hear. That is exactly what we wanted to do with the film, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You did a great, great job here. So have you started work on anything else? Can you share anything with us?
Well, as we are speaking, I'm just in Los Angeles now, and, you know, as filmmakers tend to come to Los Angeles and, you know, look for work, I'm here meeting people. I have written a new script, you know, I'm talking to producers about a new film, which is, again, something that plays in the past, but way back in the past, like 2,000 years ago. So,
wow.
yeah, really, you know, it's, I can't at this point, you know, disclose what it's about, but you know, I'm working on something else. Yeah.
Oh, we'd love to have you back when it's closer to that release and when you can share more with us.
Yeah, it would be lovely.
Yeah, and because again, this is a great film. Again, it's called Colonia, co-writer, director, Florian,
and Academy Award winner. Don't forget.
Oh yeah, yeah, of course.
Well, okay, cool.
Yeah. Yeah,
thank you so much.
Thank you so much, and thank you for making this movie. Again, if you look at this movie and you think, oh, you know, I don't want to see history lesson. You know what? You're not. You get the history, but you also get a very entertaining experience. Take it from me. Go see this movie, everyone.
Cool.
Yeah, thank you, Florian.
Yes.
Have a great weekend.
Thank you, guys. So much for joining us.
Yeah, bye. It was a pleasure.
Thank
bye.
You. Thank you.
Yeah, it is really good. And again, we have a great villain here in Michael Nyquist. He does a great job here.
Did you not know he won an Academy Award?
Yeah, I knew.
How come you didn't bring that up?
Well,
I mean, that's pretty important, don't you think?
It is. It is. I know. Well, you could have asked him a little bit about that.
Well, I just looked it up. I just looked him up 2 seconds ago.
Oh, okay.
And saw that he won an Academy Award. But since you knew who he was before I did, you should have kind of brought that up.
I'm sorry. Well, I was focusing on the film
absolutely,
itself.
Absolutely, yeah. And I think it's just because this was such a somber thing. You know, a lot of people know that there were a lot of Nazis that escaped down to South America. And...
That's where Hitler is right now.
If he's still alive. No, but, you know, Argentina, Chile, like that. But it's amazing. I mean, my parents lived there for 2 years, and I used to go visit them a lot, and I never knew about Colonia. But I guess I never asked.
Yeah.
You know?
And the way that the wall and the gates and everything, I mean, it looks really creepy.
Well,
you know, on the poster.
It is.
So, yeah.
It is really creepy. Yeah. But I just wonder, I wish I didn't want to ask him this. Well, I wanted to ask him this, but I didn't think it was appropriate to ask that. But if the cult is allowing them to come in, I just wonder if anybody's asked, how do they feel about what happened there?
Yeah, yeah.
Or do they still condone it, even though it's not necessarily happening? That's scary to me.
Right, and have they seen the film?
I mean, Pinochet had, that whole regime was very scary. But
oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, you get the after the little history lessons afterward, they show you what happened to mm-hmm. everyone. And so, again, a great film. We've talked about 3 great films today so far.
I know. Yeah. Amazing. This yeah. I mean, you go from drought to flood.
Yeah. Yeah. The Jungle Book, I really liked. And then 13 Cameras and Colonia. You've got to go see these movies. And they're making it easier. They're available on video on demand. So if you can't make it out of the theater, I mean, out of the home, maybe you want to be watched by someone, or maybe you're stuck in a Colonia, you could just check it out on video on demand.
Well, that's true. And you know what? I kind of do like the fact that you have that option.
I do too.
Because you can't always make it to the theater in time. And now people are having these phenomenal home theaters as well. That if you can see something that's contemporary, see it now, but see it in the comfort of your own home if you want and have that as an option. Or even if you go see it in the movie theater and you liked it so much, but there's so much depth to it, you want to see it again, you can watch it a video demand at your home.
Yeah, and a lot of people
you can pause it, rewind, etc.
A lot of people discount the video on demand releases. They say, oh, these are too small. These are not small movies. I mean, Emma Watson, Daniel Brühl, Michael Nyquist in Colonia, you know, that great cast. And then with 13 Cameras, what an amazing experience that is. And of course, with Neville Archambault. Well, let's take another quick break. We've got some more movies to talk about after in our next segment.
Is that the correct number?
Yes, it is the correct number. Colonel.
Colonial. Colonial.
Well, it's spelled that way, kind of. Colonel. Colonel Happy's March from the original Jungle Book. You know, the elephants.
Mm-hmm.
And the elephants actually have a nice scene in the new Jungle Book.
Really?
Yeah, Mowgli does a solid for one of them. I'm just going to tell you that.
Yay.
And it is a great movie, The Jungle Book, again. We are hearing all of our songs. And I have a feeling we're going to hear Bare Necessities a couple more times before all is said and done. Breakthrough Entertainment right here on KPHX 1480 AM. We will be right back.
Are you suffering from back pain or joint problems? Is stress getting the best of you? Do you want to lose a few pounds? Try healing powers of hot yoga Bikram Yoga Peoria. Hot yoga is therapeutic, restorative, and rejuvenating. Bikram Yoga Peoria is offering 90-minute hot yoga classes. Mention Breakthrough Thinking to receive one complimentary class, one free healthy meal protein shake, and one free wellness assessment. Benefits of hot yoga include reducing high cholesterol, reducing high sugar, improving flexibility, endurance, energy, and strength, improving metabolism, and burning fat. What are you waiting for? Pick up the phone and call now to claim your free ticket to change your life. 623-486-3843. Mention Breakthrough Thinking. That's 623-486-3843. And online, BikramYogaPeoria.com. That's B-I-K-R-A-M, YogaPeoria.com.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Birenbaum and Spien PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you. Communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Birenbaum and Spien works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
Necessities, oh Mother Nature recipes, that bring the bare necessities of life. Wherever I wander, wherever
welcome
I
back gone. To Breakthrough. Oh,
you know, I couldn't be. Oh,
welcome back to Breakthrough Entertainment on KPHX 1480.
I haven't seen you this animated in a long time, Joseph. You love this Jungle Book.
This ain't animated. This is live action.
It's all CG.
It is. No, but I'm talking about you being so animated.
It's
you're
all
bouncing
CG.
Out of your chair.
Lou Rawls with Bare Necessities from Jungle Cubs, the cartoon, the sitcom version, kind of, you know.
Of the Jungle Book.
Of the Jungle Book. Yes. Besties of life. Oh, yeah.
I had cocktails with Lou Rawls.
You did?
Yes, I did.
You did? Wow.
He lived in Cave Creek.
Really?
Yeah, so we
I think he is so talented.
Did he ever sing that for you?
I would probably be awestruck.
He's dead now.
Well, no, but I'm saying if I were you, I would probably be awestruck.
I'm never that way.
Did he never
see I there's very few people that I am, and you guys are gonna laugh at me, but actually do you remember Eight Is Enough?
Yes.
Okay. Willie Ames, who played
I used to run into Willie Ames too.
Yeah,
he's
yeah.
In Southern California.
Well California. See, I ran into him in Hawaii with his girlfriend, but it was so funny because it was like 20 years after the fact. Here I am, a mother with my own kids, and it's like he walked up and I was just like it was funny.
Williams.
But yeah, so anyway, I mean, I got over it like that, but it was just one of those things where it just caught me by surprise because I wasn't expecting it.
I saw his band play at Disneyland in the, what's the future land called?
Yeah. Tomorrowland.
Yeah, Tomorrowland.
Yeah, mm-hmm. They had that bar there with the stage that came out of the ground. His band was playing there.
Cool. Nice.
Yeah.
Well, that was a long time ago.
Yep, it was. Well, even when I saw him was a long time ago.
Yes. And,
but Jermaine Jackson, I saw him in customs at the airport, too. Well, that's where I seem to meet everybody.
Well, I get starstruck a lot. I mean, even though we talk to all these cool people, you see, you know, I get excited. You know, even talked to Neville earlier, and I was like very, very excited because, you know, he was so talented.
Yeah, he is. He is an incredibly talented. And Florian, my gosh, Oscar Award winner and just, you know, phenomenal talent himself.
And so. I get to talk to all these people all the time, but, you know, I still get very excited, you know, just even hearing their voices and stuff, you know, so... very exciting. And once again, I think we haven't said our names the last couple segments. I am Joseph J. Erdo, aside Trisha.
I am Trisha.
And Eric Reinert behind the glass.
With the beautiful Kathleen.
Hi, Kathleen.
She's so gorgeous.
She's waving. She's waving to all of our listeners.
You are a lucky man, Mr. Eric. That's all I can say.
Yes, I know.
Careful there. Careful.
And she's lucky,
don't
too.
Don't you ever forget it. Yes, she is lucky as well.
Oh, but she's not lucky, too? Yeah,
I said she is lucky as well.
Oh, she doesn't look.
Hey,
she's...
you keep that smile on her face.
Okay. don't want to know how he does that, but.
I think it's bewilderment.
Well, if anyone has any comments for us, give us a call 602-252-1480, 602-252-1480.
How are we going to squeeze the rest of these films
I don't
into
know.
Such we're, a short period of time?
We're going to go through them fairly quickly.
I hope you
quickly.
Took your Adderall.
Oh, yeah. Adderall Diaries. Good transition there. The Adderall Diaries, James Franco plays a novelist who, paralyzed by writer's block and an escalating Adderall dependency, simultaneously delves into the details of a murder case with the help of a reporter, played by Amber Heard, and reunites with his estranged father, played by Ed Harris. He's forced to separate truth from lies and fact from fiction, ultimately leading him to finally reconcile his past and confront his future. Great cast in this, right?
Yes. Oh, an incredible cast. Yes. Yeah.
Opened up yesterday. I think this one's also available on video on demand, but it's also playing in a few theaters. Judging from star James Franco's committed performance, the actor really, really wanted The Adderall Diaries to be good. Unfortunately, try as he might, the new drama never amounts to much. This is based on a memoir by Stephen Elliott.
Very, very large selling series. Or
yes.
Book. Yeah.
Yeah. And it frequently jumps from plot point to plot point and tone to tone.
Well, that's how it is when you're on Adderall.
Yeah. Well, and that's what.
Exactly.
Right. Right. And
not
that's,
like I'd know.
You don't have a dependency on that?
I don't.
Okay. I'm sorry, Eric. Well, I think that is the intended effect for the audience, but it doesn't make for a very particularly pleasant, let alone coherent experience. You know, it just was like, I felt like I had hyperactivity and impulse control issues.
Ooh.
Watching this movie.
Okay.
So the movie itself has that. I'm only giving it one star. So did not very much care for The Adderall Diaries, but James Franco does a pretty good job. So that's what the one star is for him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, another one.
Well, I think Ed Harris did a good job as the father, too.
Yes, yeah.
You know, especially when they had that confrontation.
Yes, Ed Harris did a good job as well.
Yeah, I thought that was good.
Joseph, did you see 11/22/63?
No, I did not.
That was pretty good.
That's James Franco, right? Yeah, the series, right?
Yeah, it was an 8-part mini series.
Right.
It was a Stephen King story.
Yeah. I'm watching Bates Motel. I know you like that as well, right?
Oh, is that back?
Yeah, it's back. It's been back.
Well, we have to check that out.
Yeah, it's. I think they're on.
Is that only on Netflix or is that?
That's on.
All right, so it might be on Hulu. I'll have to look for it.
Not TBS. The other one. I forget.
You forget.
Yeah. Well, I can't remember it right now. But High Strung is another movie that opened up last weekend, actually.
Now, that was one I am excited to be able to see because I absolutely love dance.
Yeah, well, and this one is about a violinist busking in the New York City subway who encounters a classical dancer on scholarship at the Manhattan Conservancy of the Arts. With the help of a hip-hop dance crew, they must find a common ground while preparing for a competition that could change their lives forever. It was playing at a few theaters last weekend. I think you can still see it this weekend at AMC Deer Valley. Great theater over there. If you're seeing High Strung for its dynamic dance number, then you're bound to be sufficiently satisfied and even energized. If you're seeing it for the sophisticated story and complex characters, then you've clearly overestimated the capacity and function of dance flicks. A lot of people don't like the Step Up franchise because, you know, they say, oh, it's so predictable and just, you know, blah, blah, blah. That's pretty much what this is. It's The movie features some spectacular sequences of choreographed movement that marries hip-hop and classical ballet, but it's underwhelming in most other areas due to its dependence on stereotypes and cliches. But still, the target audience of young aspiring dancers and musicians, and I think Trisha would fall not in that category, but people who would like this movie.
Well, I love the dance community in general.
Right.
I mean, I really, truly do. That creativity, the art, it doesn't matter what your background is, and I think that's what they're trying to get across in franchises like Step Up franchise and in this movie, is that, you know, you don't have to stay in your little box. You're not just a ballet dancer. You're not just a hip hop artist. You're not just a musician. You don't, you know, you can push the envelope. You can come up with something new and different and exciting and fun. And what I really love about this, and I really, you know, even if you don't go out and see it on the big screen, check it out on video on demand, because this film actually supports a really, really excellent foundation called the Dizzy Feet Foundation. Mm-hmm. And two of my favorite choreographers and dance people, Nigel Lithgow and Adam Shankman from So You Think You Can Dance, they have that foundation that they put together, and I think it's awesome, and everybody should really look into that. And I just absolutely love this combination of structured classical dance world mixed in with the rule-breaking hip-hop genre of dance, and I'm so excited. I still want to see this film. I don't care if the storyline sucks. If it's predictable.
Yeah, it's just your typical
cliche
story.
Because
yeah,
I want it. That's okay, because I just want to see it come to life on the big screen.
And
myself.
I still enjoyed it.
I'm excited for it.
By the way, as soon as the show's over, I'm going busking.
Okay, all right. What are you going to do with your guitar?
I'm just going to play guitar and put a hat on the ground.
And that's all you're going to be having? Just a hat? You're just going to wear a hat? That's it?
No, yep. He's putting the hat on the ground.
He's wearing nothing.
So
he's just the hat's on the ground.
It's the bare necessities
of
life.
Okay. So if you want to see Eric.
That's all I wear anyway.
Hey, but you know what? Hey, you have talent, and I don't care if you're a street musician or performer. If you're out there and you've got talent, go for it.
Yeah.
Because it makes everybody happy.
And, I'm giving High Strung 3 stars. You'll likely leave the theater with a pep in your step and a smile on your face.
Yay!
So despite all the cliche stuff, I still enjoyed it. And
well, and the strung part is because he's a violinist.
Well, yes. And and it's also, I was mesmerized by the dance numbers, especially the big finale and everything. It is quite something to see.
Well, you don't get much better than these guys. So
no.
Excellent.
Yeah.
I'm excited. I can't wait to see it.
And another one that came out last week, Mr. Right. Anna Kendrick plays a young woman who falls for a seemingly perfect guy, played by Sam Rockwell, who just happens to be a professional assassin whose services are solicited by a dubious client being sought by an equally dubious FBI agent, played by Tim Roth. As the bodies pile up, she needs to decide whether to flee or join in the mayhem. So three great stars in this movie. It excels on the charisma of its two stars. I was telling Trisha during the break that Anna Kendrick and Sam Rockwell don't exactly fit, so to speak. So the romantic sparks fail to fly, but the comedy certainly hits the fan, as it's always fun to watch both of these performances. Performers individually play up their unique charms for the camera. Anna Kendrick is as cute as she is kooky, even though her character is somewhat inconsistent. Sam Rockwell is as likable as he is indifferently insane. Moreover, the unique blend of dark sense of humor and the undeniable adorableness is strangely entertaining. 3 stars for Mr. Right.
Excellent.
He played an assassin, the Gong Show guy, right?
What
was that called?
Confessions of a Dangerous Mind.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So he does really good with that. He does, you know, he's a crazy actor. I love him. And finally,
he's a crazy actor, or he's an actor that does crazy well.
Yes, he does.
Okay.
He's an actor.
All right, just checking.
Well, he's probably
checking.
Crazy.
He's probably a little crazy too.
Well, someone else who we know is probably a little bit crazy is Christopher Walken, Mr. King Louie himself.
Mm-hmm.
One More Time, he stars in that with Amber Heard. Amber plays an aspiring rock star who, evicted from her Brooklyn apartment, is forced to move into the Hamptons home of her father, Christopher Walken, an over-the-hill Sinatra-esque crooner angling for a musical comeback. As the two butt heads, they unexpectedly find themselves on a journey that may redefine their lives. It has a few pleasant songs in it. You've got some of the new songs. You've got some of the crooning songs. So both ends of the age spectrum will enjoy that aspect. Unfortunately, the songs are the only moments of the movie that the word pleasant can be accurately used. The characters, especially the ones portrayed by these two great actors, are not the least bit fun to be around. It's not that they're particularly unlikable, but they come with an awful lot of emotional baggage and seem to be more interested in talking about it than doing anything about it, making for one tedious tale. So one star for One More Time.
Wow.
Yes. And I know that we've got another hour coming up with some great stuff, right, Tricia?
Oh, yes, yes. We're going to be looking into the arts scene around Phoenix. Different, plays and places that you can get some culture and enjoy.
Excellent. And I want to make sure our listeners tune in next week as well, because we're going to be doing a holiday-themed show for a new movie called Holidays. It's a horror anthology coming
out. Okay, wait a minute. That was kind of understated there. Holidays was so big, and everybody's excited about holidays, but this is not the holidays that we're all thinking about, just like Frozen for you.
Yes.
It's not like Frozen for me.
We still will be.
Because it's horror.
Yes, it's horror, but we're going to be celebrating an entire year's worth of holidays in one show.
Well, as long as we're enjoying it on the fun side and not the horrific side,
yes.
I'm okay with that.
Well, and this is Dr. John singing Bare Necessities from The Jungle Book. Again, great movie, 4 stars. Go see The Jungle Book. You'll hear this version of The Bare Necessities during the end credits. And we'll be right back on Breakthrough Entertainment.
Woo!
After this bear break. Oh, yeah.
I don't know if I can bear it.
Wherever I want,
wherever I roam, I couldn't be fond of my big home. The bees are buzzing in the tree to make some honey just for me.
It's now time for the word association game. Contestants, go ahead.
Bars. Meat market. Gas.
High prices.
Politicians.
Liars.
Auto mechanics.
Ripoff. Guys, whoa, 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 wait a minute here. Not when I think of my auto mechanic, I think of trust, care, safety, and fairness. This sounds like the definition of a friend, which was what Alexander's All Care Automotive Repair achieves with his customers. The peace of mind that comes with the mechanic that puts you first. Located at 3310 East Thomas Road, Phoenix, 85018. Call 602-956-3781. 602-956-3781.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Birenbaum and Spien PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you. Communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Birenbaum and Spien
works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
This is 1480 KP.
Welcome back again. You're listening to Breakthrough Entertainment Live, 1480 AM, KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona.
And we were playing musical chairs. We were playing musical chairs because
I was
Dave,
running out of music.
Yeah, Dave wasn't here, and then I was sitting in his spot, and then now he's here, and I had to move.
And now I'm here, and I saw
but
Eric.
I feel like I'm seeing double.
You are.
Yeah, because there's two Davids in the studio with me.
I know, but I was watching people behind the glass with their hands flailing away like
at you.
Like
he's
yeah.
going hello
well,
you're
it
live
it looked like road rage to me. It did not it just wasn't simply hand gestures. Am I right?
I was hand jiving.
Oh yeah. I saw that once. Okay, so yeah, I was off the first 2 hours. Where was I?
I think it might be tax season.
Yeah,
and you are a tax guy. Well, not CPA. A tax guy, but you're a huge CPA, yes.
A huge CPA, thanks.
With big clients. Big clients, oh, yeah. That so it's more than just taxes.
Yeah,
it's,
she's covering up now, right? A huge CPA. What, am I Donald Trump? Huge.
No, that he would say huge.
If I was Donald huge. Trump, I'd be owning the station. Is that
this
correct?
Is a huge thing.
Oh,
a
yeah.
huge thing.
That's right. Well, this is exciting. So here I am. I got a lot of work done, and I had a lovely talk with Kathleen.
Oh,
and Eric, she is so nice. I'm not kidding you, Eric.
I don't know what you're talking about, but...
Oh, no, it's just good stuff, right? Yeah.
She said good stuff.
Yeah. She is a very nice lady.
She's smart.
You are
smart.
A lucky
she's
guy,
beautiful.
Eric.
That's what we've been telling
her. I know. I keep hearing that.
Oh, yeah, you do.
It's true.
I mean, in the last hour, I heard it.
And she's lucky,
oh.
too. We will admit that. But.
I agree. I think she's like... well, let's ask her live
look
in
at
front
the grin.
Of everyone. Is she lucky?
Yes, lucky.
Yes.
She said lucky?
She said yes, lucky.
Oh, yes, lucky.
Yes. And see, you know what? I think Eric is part of the reason we never see her without a smile on her face.
Oh, is that
Have
why?
You ever seen her not smile?
No, she's always very,
and she
very
has a gorgeous.
Yeah, smiling and it makes Eric smile and then he lights up a cigarette because of activities.
Oh, stop it.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, I saw that in the movies once.
Once?
Twice? All right. I see it every night. Okay, I don't smoke. Anyway, we're excited because we have a very special guest. We met, a couple years ago, I think, in Sedona.
Yeah, the Sedona Film Festival.
That's right, yeah. Which is a great festival. And we have David Appleford. I love your last name, by the way.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
I don't know the origin.
I love his first name.
Because it reminds me of a fruit and a car.
Well, that's how I explain it, but I think the origin is Scandinavian, you know,
oh,
like
it
the
is?
Apple fjords.
Oh, yes,
but
okay.
You sound English, though.
That's right. I've not been one of those who go back into your heritage. It's, all I know is I was born where I was born, and anything
sure.
that occurred before, you know. I know there's an American habit of always wanting to know your background, and you start searching
yeah.
things, but most people in Europe just, they stop it
they
with their
care.
Birth. Yeah, they don't care.
Wow, they even have commercials. What is that called? The genealogy?
Ancestry.com?
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. I know.
But you can also do like your DNA and find out where your bloodline started, too, which I think is kind of cool.
Right.
But you have to realize that in the United States, our historical districts or our history, outside of the Native Americans, obviously, but as far as our buildings and everything, we're talking, you know, the 1800s or 1700s, 1776. And you go,
you
right?
Knew that?
Well, it's true.
You go to Europe.
Now you're insulting the guy.
No.
1776.
That was last week. That was last Thursday.
Isn't that
in the terms of world history?
Well, that's exactly, exactly. Right. So, see, if you're born in the United States, we don't have the depth of culture that you find in other countries around the world, aside from the Native American cultures that we had. Well, so that's what I'm saying is that.
Well, I'll give you a quick example. I used to do mornings at a radio station in San Diego, and it's a lovely, lovely city to be in.
Yes,
right.
It is.
But near where I live, there was a Woolworths, but it was a historic Woolworths. You couldn't touch it, and there was a placard on the side, and it said 50 years old. And I thought, well, my sister runs a pub outside of London in Beckenham, and that building alone is the 16th century.
Exactly.
So something that was 50 years ago hardly seems historic.
Yeah. Exactly. That's a good exactly. Point. But yeah. That's why I'm saying I think we're always in search for our roots.
Right. So if you ever go to Scotland, be careful. I know specifically of a store or a shop or whatever that builds itself as one of those ancestry places. They make it up on the spot.
Oh, wow.
You'll go in and they'll put your name in a computer and they'll come up with a design and they'll print
it. For your coat of arms.
Right, and all that. It's all made up. Believe me.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
Wow.
And you know who their biggest customers are?
Americans.
American tourists.
Of course, yes. So because we want to get our family coat of arms.
Right. Always beware what you're too willing to believe about your past without confirming it from a second or third source.
Well, Ted Cruz was born in Canada.
Yeah, well, and
that's all I could say.
And that's certainly an issue.
It is indeed. So let's get your background, because you're from England, like we talked about. You've been on the radio. You're a film critic. You do you look
theater.
Theater. Sort of a versatile type of guy.
Well, I came over to the United States in 82. That's when I emigrated.
1882?
Dave,
a little bit before that war was building.
You look
building.
So good for that.
But yeah, 1982, that's when I landed. And at this point, I've lived more years in the United States than in Britain. But I used to do theater in England.
Oh, you did?
And it seemed a natural progression to continue with entertainment in one way. And I went into radio.
Oh, cool.
And the nice thing about radio is it's one of those industries that if you're doing okay, you know, you get to see areas of the country through the work, and you become involved with the city through the work. So I started in North Carolina. I went on to Indiana, San Diego, as I said, back to Pennsylvania, and then I did radio for about 8 years. Are we allowed to use other call letters?
Let's ask Eric. Are we allowed to say other call stations or just say another station? But we probably shouldn't. Okay, so I would say another a different station.
Another FM station in town.
Oh, there you go.
But very well known, because at Christmas, boy, do you get the season.
Now you're going too far.
So I think you know which one. But, so I was about 8 years there. And the nice thing about that industry, television and radio, is that when you do get pulled or invited to another part of the country, you become automatically involved with the city, because obviously the radio station is a voice of that city. So you, by default, have to plunge headfirst into whatever's going on. So rather than someone who moves there because the electric company moved them or whatever, when you do radio and television, you become a part of that city. And, you know, within a couple of months, you tend to know most of the streets, the pronunciations of things, people who are involved, all that kind of business. And it's a great thrill. And it's certainly a great ride, and it has been.
Oh, yeah, I can imagine. And I love your website, by the way. I want to give a plug, because... And so do you, Tricia. I mean, you pointed it out to me, in fact.
Oh, yeah. His website's
really
incredible.
It's really nicely laid out, but a lot of nice reviews and easy to find. It's easy to navigate the website. That's important to have a website that you can navigate.
Right. Well, the intention was, in the style of writing, that when I no longer was reviewing for the radio station, I would write in a slightly different way. Mm. And the approach is that it's for movie buffs and theater buffs. There's no really compromising with the examples that you give, because, you know, when I was growing up, you'd read, some of the, and I'm not referring to People magazine or something that gives a quick thumbs up, thumbs down, something that does an analysis. Mm-hmm. And the reference in there, I would run down to the library and just look it up, because that was the way you learn. Today, it's even easier, because you can split your screen on the monitor, and if there's a reference that you don't quite get, within a second or two, to. You can look it up. So yeah. I decided rather than do the radio approach, the three S's, short, simple, and stupid, because whether you like it or not, that's a lot of the training in radio for mass audiences. I decided to change the style somewhat and write for people who are actually interested in the subject to the point where even if they don't get the reference, they might go out of their way to look it up.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah, it piques their interest, right. and it actually educates as well, right. Which is nice, or allows people to self-educate.
Yeah, I like to think so. I actually approach each review as a kind of college paper. I mean, it doesn't read like a college paper.
Oh, no, most definitely it does not. It's wonderful.
The idea, though, is if you make a statement, then support it with a couple of examples that will illustrate what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Don't just make a sweeping statement like, a right-wing talk show host who will just say something but won't necessarily back it up with real examples. Give examples in there, and whether the person reading it agrees or not agrees with your overall view of it, you know, you can't really argue with an example if it's solid, and the reference is true too. So mm-hmm. That's how I try to do it, and there are two different approaches is to film and theater, but the overall idea is that it's written for those who are interested specifically in the subject.
And I have your website up right now. It really is sharp. I got to say.
I didn't expect this.
But it really is. Valley Screen and Stage. David Appleford. See, I didn't even pronounce my own name right.
I know.
David Appleford's
scary.
Film and theater reviews at Appleford.com. Wait a minute. That's not right. It's davidappleford.com.
Well, the actual URL, the address is a little more complicated.
It is appleford.left.
Coast X.
Yeah.
Who could remember that?
I typed in one thing. I'm looking at the address bar and it changed on me.
Well, it's very easy to do. You just type in davidappleford.com and it will direct you immediately to that site.
It really is nice. This is a very well laid out website.
Well, it's easy to navigate, like you said. And what I absolutely love about it is that, you know, you have movie reviews and that you can get in so many different places. You can see a movie review. But what I love is your style that you were just talking about in your reviews, but also that you have live performances, stage performances, other things that are happening here around the Valley in addition to that. And, you know, you are active in the scene with the film festivals. That's where we've seen you the last couple of years as well. But just your style is just very...
Engaging.
That's okay. A very good word. That's an excellent word.
That's how I said it.
Yeah,
thank you very much.
Let me point out, I didn't agree to come here just to hear this, but I love it anyway.
Well, we love to give compliments, and especially when they're well-deserved, and it is well-deserved.
Well, one of the nice things I have to tell you is since leaving the unnamed station that I did movie reviews for and theater reviews here in Phoenix, the hits on the online magazine have shot up, which is... I feared that once you weren't quite in the public eye on a regular basis that it would go the other way, but it didn't. It actually did much better, which is good.
It is definitely good. Let me ask you... we got a few more minutes till our first break. What the difference is between writing reviews for film versus theater?
Well, there are very distinctive differences because the overall voice that I use is still the writing style. But obviously, if you're reviewing theater, you have to look for other elements within that proscenium arch on stage that you don't do with film. One thing I'm also very conscious of is that if I'm writing a review that, say, Gwyneth Paltrow's in, I don't think she's going to read that review. But you're very conscious when you write local professional theater that those actors, directors, and everyone involved in it, and relatives of those involved in it, are going to read your review. And so you're very conscious of the fact that someone is going to go through it, and you try to get it as right and as fair as possible.
That's tricky, isn't it? Because, you know, over the years we've had a lot of guests, and certainly we're here to help and to give exposure to independent filmmakers particularly. But, you know, it's sort of politically, is it politically challenging for you if you really don't like something and you know the lead people are going to read it? How do you approach it? Do you approach it differently?
No, not really. You, as long as, again, those examples that you give, you don't want to just say, didn't rise to the occasion or just wasn't good enough. You have to explain why. And hopefully in the explanation, the reason will come out. And I hope to think it's fair. But if you see enough movies, as a lot of, you know, obviously the reviewers do, you can average 5-6 a week sometimes, you get to know the fact that many of them are pretty mediocre.
Yeah.
Whereas with the theater, especially our local professional pool of talent that we have here, the majority tends to be very, very good. And I even have some favorite actors and actresses and some favorite venues. And I now live in constant fear that they're going to let me down on the next one because I don't particularly want to write anything negative.
I hear you.
Yeah. It is much easier. It's wrong to... I don't want anyone to think you go in with knives and you want to slice a movie about.
Correct.
But films give you so many opportunities to knock
them.
They do. Whereas, you know, with my own theater background, as I was an actor and I directed some things... there's a different appreciation when reviewing theater. I actually review it from a worker's point of view, knowing what work had to go into it. And I think there's a nice balance between doing both because if you just review theater but you have very little film knowledge, some of the decisions that you see on stage you may be a little questionable in the same way the other way around. If all you ever do is see films, but you don't know the origin of their adaptations and you can't compare with the original work, then I think you might be missing out on something there. You can't always tell how successful a movie version of a play is because if you don't know the original play in the first place.
Mm-hmm. So that's true. But that's very true.
This is really interesting, though. I think this is a great discussion because you know, you have film critics, you have people reviewing theater. Everyone has different criteria. Maybe in school they teach you how to review a film, I suspect, at some of the major schools. But my question is this, is that, you know, the average moviegoer has a criteria, and they even have different criteria. But however, were they entertained or were they not?
Yes.
And but does that put a little bit different emphasis in on the movie, you know, critic to look at it sometimes through the average person's eyes? Because
I try to do both.
Yeah.
You certainly want to know the entertainment value of a film and how the average moviegoer will think, because obviously that's the prime reason why it was filmed in the first place.
And isn't that the reason why you're reviewing it, too? Because people are going to look at that.
True, but in the same way you might look at a painting of a Mona Lisa. If you know something of the subject, you're going to point out little things that perhaps don't work.
Sure.
That's why I say I write for the movie buff, who are interested in more than seeing it just as entertainment.
Gotcha.
But I still take that into consideration. And I have to tell you, there are some films that I've seen wearing the critic's hat that when it was released about 3 or 4 months later as a DVD, I've just played it again for the fun of it at home, and you start seeing it in a very different way.
Yeah,
it's almost because you want to like it, you ignore the faults.
Yeah, exactly.
But obviously, as a reviewer, you can't, because that's why you're there.
That's like being married. You sort of try to ignore the faults.
I'm not even sure I could comment on that.
Well, that's a whole different
subject.
We
should say to listeners, this is man and wife in the studio with me.
Yeah, this is interesting.
So don't think I'm going to back you up on that.
Good point. So I'll tell you, why don't we take a quick break, and when we come back, let's talk more about theater, because we love theater. Arizona Theater Company is fantastic.
We bump into each other there.
Exactly.
We do,
exactly.
And you go to a lot more, and we'd love to hear some of the other theaters as well. And this is Breakthrough Entertainment Live, 1480 AM KPHX. We'll be right back.
It's now time for the word association game. Contestants, go ahead.
Bars. Meat market. Gas.
High prices.
Politicians.
Liars.
Auto mechanics.
Ripoff.
Guys, whoa, 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 wait a minute here. Now, when I think of my auto mechanic, I think of trust, care, safety, and fairness. This sounds like the definition of a friend, which was what Alexander's All Care Automotive Repair achieves with his customers. The peace of mind that comes with a mechanic that puts you first. Located at 3310 East Thomas Road, Phoenix, 85018. Call 602-956-3781. 602-956-3781.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Birenbaum and Spien PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you. Communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Birenbaum and Spien works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
And welcome back again. You're listening to Breakthrough Entertainment Live, 1480 AM KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona. Eric, did you miss me the first couple hours?
No, Dave, because you were sitting right in the other room.
Oh, yeah.
He had one eye on you because you were out there with Kathleen.
What? What? The lights were on. Okay. So, no, it was fun. Anyway, we're here. I'm here for the last hour. And we have such a great special guest. First of all, I'm Dave. Trish is in studio. Woo-hoo! Eric behind the glass. And our special guest, David Appleford, theater, film critic, phenomenal. Am I right?
Did I write this and you just...
No, really, seriously.
No, it really is. I just love your website. You know, that's the thing, of not the future, it's here right now. I mean, social media, so important. Yes. You know, so important to get your name out. But we were going to talk, before we talk about theater, by the way, because we really love theater as well, and I know you do, is AMC's new proposed policy. Do you want to go over that?
For film theaters.
Yeah.
Yeah, the texting. You should point out then that what it is, AMC Theater are proposing the idea that young people, they call them the millennials,
yes,
but it means anybody really who goes to the movie theater should be allowed to text.
During the movie.
Right.
But AMC's the one that has that turn off your cell phones. It's distracting.
Well, they should. It's an asinine idea.
With all those lights, it is.
It's appalling. It's absolutely appalling. I mean, you go to any screenings for films, they pad you down before you go in. And
they do.
They take your cell phone.
Yeah, it's like going through security at an airport on some... If it's a Disney movie, don't even drive to the theater with your phone.
Because
your phone. Because you're not going
to get... vehicle? She said don't drive to the theater with your vehicle. So, Eric, how
does
that
bike.
Work? Oh.
Thumb a ride, get there somehow. But don't take your phone because they'll package it and they give you a number and you have to pick it up when you come out.
What they did with me with one of the screenings that
I
went to.
And they should do that. You shouldn't take your phone in unless you're a doctor on call. There's no reason to have your phone in a movie theater. It takes you out of the magic of what you're watching. And anyone who says, well, you know, babysitters and that, what did you do 2 or 3 years ago when it wasn't a habit?
When you didn't have a cell phone.
It is really not that necessary. And what are you texting while watching a movie?
But, you know, that happened.
It takes you out of the movie.
Actually, Eric, that happened to me once. They took my phone, but it was in a city in Nevada, like Beatty, Nevada or something.
And why did they take your phone?
Okay.
Oh, I see.
Oh, that's what he was waiting for.
You were at a ranch, right?
All right. I'm not saying I was at a ranch, but okay.
Say no more. Say no more. But no, I think it's a stupid idea. And it's actually encouraging something that should be going in the other direction.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, I mean, haven't people actually gotten didn't somebody get shot or stabbed for a cell phone out in the theater?
The last thing you want to do is see someone's screen suddenly light up as if they've just put the lighter on. It's so distracting.
Yeah, it is.
Who are you texting in the middle of the movie that's taking you out of the film? When I watch a DVD at home...
You don't text.
I don't answer the phone. I don't do anything. Whoa. I'm watching the film. I'm committed to watching that.
Nice attitude. Yeah. I like that. So, that's strange. We'll see what happens on that. But the world is changing, as you could tell, politically as well as everything.
There are some theaters around the country, I want to tell, that have wired their walls to the building so that you cannot pick up a signal inside.
Oh.
Once the movies, you can't use it. It blocks...
electronic.
Yeah, there's a magnetic field that won't allow you. And I was thinking, now that's a good idea.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
And their business, I said, if you're a doctor on call, if you are, why are you going to the movies in the first place? So there's no reason to have a phone during the period of watching a movie.
It makes sense, except the addiction that the millennials have, because they can't seem to do anything. It's like, remember the commercial, don't leave home without, the American Express card or whatever? People they go berserk if they leave without what they think is their security blanket, a cell phone, right? Don't you think?
Well, it's bad enough that they use the world as a private payphone in the first place. Because remember, when we had landlines and you'd say, I need to make a call, you go into a phone booth, you close the door for privacy. Now that people are walking around having loud conversations, allowing everybody to hear everything.
It's true.
The whole world has become their private phone booth. And the last thing you want is a movie theater, or especially a live theater. Yeah. I mean, there's a famous story of Kevin Spacey. I think he was on a London stage, and he's doing a performance, and he could keep hearing this phone ringing and ringing from the audience. He stopped the play. He looked out to the area where the phone was ringing, and he said, "Will you please answer the phone?" You don't want that kind of thing to ruin your habit. AMC have stepped in the wrong direction. It's greed, actually, when you think in terms of, they say to invite the millennials to come in. It shows no respect for the product that they are promoting, which is the movie.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Mm-hmm.
Well, no, and I totally and completely agree with you on that one, because I just think that it's ridiculous to have... I remember the shows that we used to have for kids that were Sesame Street, The Electric Company, things like that. And then I would see that it would move. And these millennials have grown up with children's TV shows, et cetera, just flashing from one thing to another thing to another thing to another thing. They would see Sesame Street and go, this is boring. but the problem is that ADD is on the rise. All the rest of this stuff supposedly is on the rise, or we're noticing it more differently. But I really think that we are... allowing that to happen by allowing these distractions to continually be in our lives.
Sure.
You know, you turn your phone off and you have a moment to, when you go to a movie, you're supposed to become enveloped in the story.
Absolutely.
That's the idea of having the big screen, the dark room. You know, you want to be involved and become a part of that movie and become engrossed in that film or in that play with the characters and everything. And if you have that kind of a distraction, I think you're going to lose a lot of people, because I will not go if people are going to be texting and their phones lighting up or whatever.
Think of this as two ways. A movie theater or a live theater, the auditorium, it's not an extension of your living room. You don't act and talk and speak and use phones in the same way. It's also not... it's not a public auditorium either. You've paid a ticket. You've paid a price. Everybody has paid the same price in order to get there. So once you're on the inside, it is now private. It's not public. It's not open for you to do and say and behave in any way you want. And that certainly includes phones. Mm-hmm. Turn the darn things off, or leave them in your car, or don't take them in the first place. AMC should be ashamed of themselves.
Wow, and AMC is on line one now. Let's take the call. No, I'm kidding. Oh, you look worried, didn't you?
No, but I'm just saying I'm amazed, because, I mean, I that's actually my go-to theaters in San Diego.
But it is just proposed, you know? Right?
So yeah, I don't think they're doing it, but the fact that it's been leaked and it's now a news item.
Maybe they're just trying to get some feedback.
Maybe it's people like us talking about it now and they want to see
publicity.
What the reaction
is.
Yeah, it could
hit
be.
It the news cycle.
It could be. Well, it's, you know, they were talking about being able to leave your cell phone on when you're on the airplane because it supposedly didn't interfere with the radar like everybody thought it might.
Yeah.
But then, I mean, even before takeoff, when you're even on a delayed flight, when you're in that little, you know, that plane, even though I say little, but, you know, 145 or whatever people, and somebody's on their phone and talking too loudly or talking inappropriately, right. And you just want to turn around. And I'm not a person who's known for plane rage or car rage or whatever you want to call it, road rage. But I felt like turning around and just saying, can you please watch your language?
Sure,
there are kids here.
Absolutely.
And this person was dropping F-bombs and doing, and I'm just like, seriously?
They were?
Yeah, on the phone.
Oh.
And for some people, that's their vernacular, which is fine, but not if you
not in
are.
Public.
Well, and people can't leave. A parent can't take their child away from you if they're sitting because you're out on the tarmac waiting to take off, you know, and you're parked over there because there's an air traffic control hold, so they're allowing people to use their phones. And it's like, you know, it's one thing to text or check your emails or whatever, but to be having a conversation that's inappropriate or too loud or just really anything shy of, I'm going to be a little bit late, sweetie.
Well, here's the bottom line. This is the bottom line. I don't know so much about the technology of planes and whether it interferes with it, but Tris was right. I've heard that it doesn't anymore. But it does affect a live theater performance. It affects the audience's reaction because they're distracted. It affects the actor who can hear it, especially in a very quiet passage.
Oh, yeah.
And in as far as movies, it might not affect those performances that are being reflected on a screen, but it still spoils it for the audience around them because it constantly takes you out of the magic of the moment.
Totally.
So the answer is, do not do it.
We agree. We're going to have a vote. And okay, it's unanimous. Well, wait, we didn't get Eric and Kathleen's votes. Do you want texting during film, like movie theaters?
What would I be texting?
Well, I mean,
well, there we are.
Allowing
the point.
People.
Would you allow texting?
I prefer when people put their phones away.
Okay. And Kathleen?
It's distracting when you can see their screen.
Yeah. I agree, totally.
So
okay,
I think all of us
unanimous.
Are in agreement.
It's unanimous, and we'll take this to AMC and have a discussion with their CEO.
Case closed.
Case closed, no doubt. Let's talk a little bit about theaters. Now, we talked about the Arizona Theater Company. What a great place. I mean, the Herberger, our great friend Steve Carr, tremendous PR guy. How nice is that guy? And how effective is he and how professional?
Very, very,
the top,
very.
Don't you think?
Well, I do.
Just love that guy.
And, you know, you've used a good example because Arizona Theater Company are one of the premier.
Tremendous.
Their standard is so high. I sat next to, I remember an audience member a few plays back and just striking up a conversation, as you sometimes do. And she says that she was a subscriber. She only goes to the Herberger to see Arizona Theater Company. And the reason is, she said it's her Broadway fix. She wasn't referring to the national Broadway tours that go to ASU Gamage.
Right.
Because, you know, Gamage is such a massive auditorium.
It is.
Even though the what they're showing is terrific, the auditorium itself doesn't reflect Broadway or even London West End theaters, but the Herberger does.
Yes.
And because the standard of ATC's productions are so high, that's what she was referring to. Seeing at least one of their productions every few months gives her, since she's moved to Phoenix away from New York, this is her Broadway fix.
Wow, that is cool stuff. And we saw our last play, we saw Fences.
Mm-hmm.
Unbelievable, right?
Mm-hmm.
Best I've ever seen.
Well, and the thing is that I was... And this sounds very bad of me, but coming from the West Coast, and I love New York and the theater scene, and I even love the West End in London. But I really had no idea how many outlets of culture and the arts are available here at such high quality.
Right.
I mean, it blew me away. The first show that I saw there in this fairly intimate theater, I was like, wow. I love it. Yeah, so very impressive.
They're a leading company, but the good thing is, for those who love live theater and don't realize it, there's a massive pool of tremendous professional talent here in Maricopa County. Yeah. There are plenty of outlets, youth theaters as well. Mm-hmm. A lot of the community theaters, their standard is high, because a lot of the actors that you see on the professional stage, you might see them turning him up in one of the community theater productions, because first it keeps their hand in, mm-hmm. And it also raises the standard of that particular production. So there's a lot of really very good stuff here, and I'm so thrilled to be able to see. I can't see everything, but the key players in this. The week is, for me, is split into two. Monday through Thursday is screenings for movies, and then Friday, Saturday, and Sunday is usually a matinee, live theater, whatever.
Busy guy. Now, take us around town a little bit to different theaters. We talked about the Arizona Theater Company at the Herberger.
Well, they're currently doing Of Mice and Men at the moment. Yeah. Sadly, it's the one opening in almost 8 years of seeing shows that I didn't go to. I had to do an emergency trip overseas, but the show that I missed, and I hear is very good, Of Mice and Men,
yes.
And that's closing this weekend.
Oh.
From what I've read, from what I know, and of course, from the previous high standard I've seen, try and go. Play it again, Sam, over at the Fountain Hills Theater. If you're willing to drive that far, obviously those in Fountain Hills, it's right on this
poster.
But they're doing the very funny Play It Again, Sam. And also Smokey Joe's Cafe, the Desert Foothills Theater. Also a high standard of production. And Legally Blonde at Mesa Community College. These are all shows that are, I believe, are closing this weekend.
Yeah.
So if you're looking for live theater and any of those appeal to you, go online and check them out and see what you can do. But there are so many others. For instance, the Valley U Theater.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, Valley U Theater, there's a lot of great talent that has sprung from there. That's why I go, because it's a way of seeing the future talent but on stage at the Phoenix Theater. They're doing a show right now called Pinkalicious. It goes on until the 24th. I haven't seen it, so it's not as if I'm saying a recommendation for the production, but Value Theater under Bob Cooper's direction is always interesting. Yeah. You know, there are names that have sprung from it, by the way. I don't know if you know. Max Crumb, local talent, he's from Value Theater, and he was on Broadway in Greece. There's a young lady called Chelsea Kane. She's with the Disney Channel. And perhaps the most famous of all is movie actor Emma Stone. Mm-hmm. The family come from Paradise Valley. She's an alumni of Value Theater. In fact, I understand that Bob Cooper, who I say runs Value Theater, they keep in touch constantly. And and we know Emma Stone, of course, Spider-Man.
Everything.
Yeah. She's about to be Billie Jean King in a movie called The Fight of the Century. You know about that?
Oh, yes.
Movie.
She's going to play Billie Jean.
Awesome.
I've seen pictures. I don't know about the physical build from the neck down, but certainly the face with the wig and the glasses.
Really?
She's got
who
Billie Jean
King. Who plays Bobby Riggs?
I have no clue. It's to come out a little later in the year.
That's too funny. Wow.
But Emma sprang from Valley U Theater.
I had no idea. That is awesome to know.
Theater Works right now are doing Vanya and Sonia, Masha and Spike. And we saw that, I believe, Herberger, again, going back to Arizona Theater Company.
Did we see that? I'm trying to remember.
It was a very, very good
show.
What
was it called?
Vanya and Sonia, and Masha and Spike.
Wow, I don't know if I saw that.
Oh, no, we didn't.
Maybe that one went by you. It's terrific.
I like the title, though.
Really? It was done on Broadway. The lead, I've forgotten his name now. He was Frasier's brother.
Oh,
Niles.
Yeah. Oh, he's
Niles,
cool.
Yes.
I like him.
He was the lead in when it was on Broadway.
Oh, wow.
Scottsdale Desert Stages, they're doing 9 to 5. And right now at Scottsdale Desert Stages Theater, the smaller theater, there's only about 4 rows. It's very intimate.
Oh.
They're doing an outstanding production of Glengarry Glen Ross, which was directed by Virginia Oliveira. I think Virginia may have been here at some point earlier for an interview. But anyway, her show, Glengarry Glen Ross, is running right now, and it's outstanding. It was one of those shows that I went thinking, well, I know I'm going to enjoy because I like the piece.
Yeah.
But I wasn't prepared for how well they had done it. And considering that the actual theater setting that they're in only has 4 rows, that's very intimate.
How does that happen? How many seats are those? 4 rows?
Not sure. It can't be many, can it?
Like
it's wide, though. It's as wide as the theater.
So maybe, wide as the theater. So let's have a guess. I'm going to say 200 to 300 people?
Say there's about 15 per row.
Oh, 15 per row?
Yeah, it's not a big place. It's it's being done as originally written. I don't know if you know Glenn Ross, but it's pretty much a profane-ridden piece by David Mamet. But the great thing is the director has left everything in, and that's exactly as it should be. I mean, the characters in the play, they're shockingly profane, but being PC, even if David Mamet himself took them out in a version...
Yeah.
It has no place. You've got to have them in Glengarry Glen Ross, and it's outstanding. Here's something to remember, by the way, about Desert Stages. I made a note. I thought it was very important. During the fall this year, Desert Stages are moving out of its current location on Scottsdale Road, and they're going into its new, I would say, expansive location that was previously Harkins Theatre in the Scottsdale Fashion Square. Because if you go to the Fashion the Square,
right.
There's this whole new... Well, the area that used to have them is becoming the Desert Stages Theater.
Oh, wow. That could be a huge... Right. So more than four rows, that's for sure.
Exactly. So I think it all but guarantees that they're going to have an audience. And if they keep the standard of Glengarry Glen Ross up... They're going to have...
Smart move.
Yeah, they're doing very well. And it's currently running now, and I think it's highly recommended.
Oh, wow.
And the good thing is, when I saw it, when it opened a few weeks ago, who knows? Because it's got a fairly long run. It can only get better.
Yeah.
Because whatever things that might have been wrong on the opening night when we saw it that need to be tweaked, you often do. That's the great thing of live theater. The performance that you as a reviewer see is one version, but next night it might be completely
different.
Whereas when you see a movie, it's exactly the same, no matter what forum you see it on, whether it's your iPad or on a big screen or a DVD. But live theater changes constantly. So the version that I saw with The Notebook might be slightly different from the one they do at the matinee the next day. And that's what makes live theater so exciting.
That's right. No doubt.
And that's why when I go, you know, to New York or even here, I don't mind seeing something multiple times. Depending on who the players are, it just changes the little nuances, you know, even though the story stays the same.
That's true. And in terms of local theater, I wanted to bring out, in addition to all the adult material we have, there are some amazing...
Now, let's clarify that. Adult material.
shows that appeal more to with adult
things.
For grown-ups.
Okay.
But there are a lot
It's called mature.
I thought you said adult material, but you said adult appeal?
Well, appeal as well.
Okay.
Whichever way you want to look at it. The point that I was making, there's a lot of good theater for children as well.
Okay, gotcha.
Now, I've mentioned Valley Youth Theater, but there's another one called Spotlight Youth Theater, which is run by Kenny Grossman in Glendale.
Interesting.
And a lot of the same actors or young actors you may see on both stages. Wow. But I think with Spotlight, they tend to be the older teenagers.
Gotcha.
And they put on some audacious productions that you think, my goodness, what are they going to do it like? And often they do it surprisingly well.
A lot of good stuff here, then, saying.
So, and there's the Christian Youth Theater, and there's a lot of...
there's a dinner theater.
They actually do a lot for younger audiences there on the smaller side.
I mean the Arizona Broadway.
Arizona Broadway up in Peoria.
How do you like that?
I love it. Mostly I treat it as a date night when I go because... unlike dinner theaters around the country, this particular one has a very different approach. And even though those who live in the center of Phoenix, or in my case, down in Albuquerque, so you can't get further south, driving up to Peoria may not be such an appeal.
Right.
It's about 50 minutes if there's no traffic going there, and 50 minutes coming back. But it's well worth it. And those who live in the Glendale and Peoria area already know how good it is.
Yeah.
But I think it's still to be discovered by many here in the city itself.
Interesting.
And their standard is really very high. The first show I saw of theirs was some years ago when they did Tarzan, the Disney musical. And I didn't really like the show itself, but I loved what the theater did with it. And I think that's what's important also when you're doing when you're doing theater reviews.
The production.
Right, because recently I saw Fiddler on the Roof there.
Oh.
Fortunately, I do like Fiddler, but think of it this way. Whether you like the actual production or not, as a reviewer, so much has already been said and written about the shows. There's nothing I'm going to add that will make any difference.
Except the unique differences they do.
Yeah, except what do they do with the production? And with that Tarzan that I saw some years ago there, I was blown away with their production. The set was terrific. The performances were good. The orchestra, the singing, it was a really high standard. And I thought, well, I can't wait to see something that I actually like with of all these production values. And the food is also very good. It sounds as if I'm doing a huge endorsement here. But the reason I even mention that part is that many people who go to dinner theaters around the country, they usually are faced with a sort of buffet style.
Yeah.
You know, like
you
would go into a cafeteria.
Just some generic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. When you go here, I was so surprised. It's gourmet food. There's a menu. Waiters come to your table.
Wow.
You decide what you're going to eat, and they'll bring it to you. And then and the taste is excellent. I mean, I don't know if
they date night.
Yeah.
But no eating during the play.
No, no. Once the you know, the service over, they clear everything out.
Gotcha.
And then you can just angle your chair a little bit, and it's stadium seating, so it's staggered.
That is cool.
And then you see the show, and again, there's a big difference between, there's almost a dividing line actually between the food and those who run the theater part.
Very
and both are very high standard.
Well, let's take one more quick break, and when we come back, we will wrap up the show. We only have one segment left, can you believe it? But we'll talk maybe more theater, but maybe a couple film reviews. And we probably should do part two because we got so much to talk about.
Yeah, I think yes.
Yeah,
it's a sign of very good things.
She said yes. Okay, and this is Breakthrough Entertainment Live, 1480 AM KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona. We'll be right back.
Are you suffering from back pain or joint problems? Is stress getting the best of you? Do you want to lose a few pounds? Try healing powers of hot yoga at Bikram Yoga Peoria. Hot yoga is therapeutic, restorative, and rejuvenating. Bikram Yoga Peoria is offering 90-minute hot yoga classes. Mention Breakthrough Thinking to receive one complimentary class, one free healthy meal protein shake, and one free wellness assessment. Benefits of hot yoga include reducing high cholesterol, reducing high sugar, improving flexibility, endurance, energy, and strength, improving metabolism, and burning fat. What are you waiting for? Pick up the phone and call now to claim your free ticket to change your life. 623-486-3843. Mention Breakthrough Thinking. That's 623-486-3843. And online, BikramYogaPeoria.com. That's B-I-K-R-A-M, YogaPeoria.com.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Birenbaum and Spien PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you. Communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Birenbaum and Spien works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
Thank you.
Welcome back again. You're listening to Breakthrough Entertainment live on 1480 AM KPHX in Phoenix, Arizona. I'm Dave, alongside Trish. We have Kathleen and Eric behind the glass doing a magnificent job, as they always do.
That just made me think.
What's she doing?
Kathleen and Eric. Kathleen and Eric under the glass.
She's sitting like a duck under glass.
She's a little bit country. You're a little bit rock and roll.
Actually,
oh wait, that's
actually
not a good comparison.
She just classes up the joint. That's all I can
say. There we go. There we are. And of course, special in studio guest David Appleford.
He's got this high energy radio thing.
A great film critic. Great theater. Do we call it a theater critic or
sure,
just
yeah? Absolutely.
And just all around great guy.
I just want everything you said in writing so I can show it to others later.
Hey, we'll give you the recording as well.
Okay.
Yeah, no, we stand behind everything we say about you, David. You are incredible.
Very
and
good stuff.
We just enjoy. You're the kind of person that everybody would love to invite over for dinner and just discuss the theater. I really do feel
the
that way.
Certainly not the theater.
Oh, but no, but I'm just saying because you have such insight and. And it's just... I
got
just,
a great idea. If you want to invite David over for dinner, call 602. No, I won't get
And his
number.
Lovely wife.
Yes.
And the lovely wife. And she is very lovely.
Well, that's...
I mean, she left a message for me.
She did.
Yeah.
Well, when we called and you were in London and or in England. And so she returned the call.
Oh,
very nice. So speaking of youth theaters, you want to talk about Child's Play.
Child's Play, that's a good example. Well, here's Child's Play. Obviously, the audience is designed for children, but the performers on stage are adults. And they have some of the best professional performances in town. Mm. I love going to Child's Play. It was just a discovery not too long ago, even though they've been here for some time. But it was so enchanting to the point where I looked forward to every new Child's Play production. And they're one of those groups that I live in fear that they're going to let me down because I don't want to say anything negative. But fortunately, so far, their standard has been so good. And there are people involved there that you will see on other stages in town. Katie McFadden, for instance.
Yeah, we had her on the show. Incredible.
Really?
Incredibly talented.
And she did the one person performance for A Christmas Carol.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
With ATC. And there's also Yolanda London, who was recently in a terrific performance. I just wanted to mention her because it was so good at Phoenix Theatre when she was playing Billie Holiday. And it's only just finished its run. So unfortunately, even though I'm mentioning it, you won't be able to see it now. It was called Lady Day at Emerson's Bar and Grill. And Yolanda she played Billie Holiday, but you see her all the time at Child's Play. And I've got to tell you, on the strength of her performance alone in this one production, I would say, like Katie, she's officially the jewel in the crown atop of the valley's already considerably large pool of professional talent.
Oh, wow.
And you can see this style at Child's Play. So that is
an
endorsement.
So many good things.
Yeah, very much a huge endorsement. Phoenix Theatre does very well, too, by the way, now I mention them. And let me say one last thing on theatre. We didn't talk about the edgy theatre. We have Nearly Naked Theatre. They do some...
Wait, what's that again?
It's called...
you
like
just piqued David's interest
the,
over
the
here.
The adult material type of stuff?
kind of, yeah. They did a musical version, send up a parody of Debbie Does Dallas.
What?
Live on stage.
Really?
That's Nearly Naked
Now, what's
theater.
This called again?
Nearly,
the Naked Theater.
Nearly Naked Theater.
Nearly.
So what do you wear, just a bow tie?
No.
Oh.
That's not the kind of question I expected.
I know. No, he. You know what? You just never know
you
what
never
you're going to get.
Damon Daring runs that. And then you have Ron May's excellent Stray Cat Theater.
Oh, we love Stray Cats. Yes, we like them as well.
And the reason I just wanted to mention them, because Ron May, who basically runs that, he is such an interesting talent. He directs, he writes, he
And he did
produces.
he did a one-man show.
Well, when
what was that?
When we were talking about Katie McFadden in Christmas Carol, Ron May, it was a kind of an unofficial double bill.
Yeah.
He did a one-person play in the evening.
I forgot what it was called,
and
though.
We saw that one.
He was Crumpet
the
Elf.
Exactly. It was the Elf Diaries.
The Elf Diaries. But he's such an interesting person, and his not everything's going to work, and I'm sure Ron will be the first to admit that, but everything you see is interesting, and having somebody in the valley like Ron May is essential. Every city should have a Ron May in their theater community.
Well, and I loved there was a piece that they did. Arizona Theater Company partnered with Stray Cats for
Oh, the writer, she's up in the cabin and the guy.
Oh, that
yeah.
was...
Oh, well, they, yeah, that's when Ron May's Stray Cat doubled with Arizona Theater
Exactly.
Company.
And
yeah.
what a phenomenal collaboration
play,
yeah. between those two. I loved it. I thought it was excellent.
Right. I think that was a dream come true for Ron himself.
Yes. Yeah.
Because he came on the stage on the opening night
with
the reviewers there.
I remember seeing that, yeah.
And you could tell in his opening speech that he was just yeah. thrilled
yeah.
to be in this position to be able to present it at the Herberger.
Yes.
And actually, Stray Cat are about to move permanently to the Tempe Center for the Performing Arts.
Oh, well,
that's where Child's Play is at, too.
Yeah, that's
Child's
right.
Play is there.
It's a great venue, great theater, and in Stray Cats, it's perfect for the parking, because if there was one nightmare yeah. of trying to see a Stray Cat theater,
parking.
Is wherever you're going to park your darn car.
That's a tough one. And mm-hmm. we only have a few minutes left, but tonight you're going to be going to see something and review.
Yeah, I'm going to the Arizona Broadway Theater that we mentioned, the Dinner Theater, for my plate of salmon. And
ooh, salmon. Good.
And they're doing the Best Little Whorehouse in Texas.
Yeah.
Now, the reason that it's worth mentioning that is one thing that ABT does. They leave the originals intact. If anybody has a favorite musical they've seen in the past, they see it's there. You're not going to see a new version or not a new reimagined thing. You're going to see pretty much as it was done. And in the case of Best Little Whorehouse, isn't it wonderful to say that, by the way?
Yes, it is.
Seeing a whorehouse on a Saturday night, that's your entertainment.
With your wife at dinner theater.
Right. The movie was just awful. I'm sorry if you're a Dolly Parton, Burt Reynolds fan, but it was not the show. It was actually a vehicle for stars, and that's not the way it should be, because the real star is the show itself. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm hoping that we'll see tonight.
Oh,
I mean, I'll have
exciting.
My notebook. I'm not going to prejudge, but I am looking forward to seeing it. I saw it with the Broadway cast in the late 70s, and it was wonderful. And then you see the film, and you think, oh, my goodness.
A much
Hollywood,
different.
Get out of the way.
Mm-hmm. So what time does that start?
Oh my gosh! I think they start serving dinner at 5:30. Sounds like an ad now. I think they start serving dinner at 5:30. The show's at 7:30. But
no, the ad was the salmon plate.
Yeah,
that's what got him. Yeah, he was like,
salmon is good.
He loves salmon. So
I'm thinking of health in that particular case.
Yeah.
But they do it very well.
Yeah,
not to keep
so
laboring that point.
You know, there's so many choices. It's absolutely amazing. But let's get contact information out for you. If you want people to...
If they want to read the website, that's easy. The easiest way is just my name. The site itself, the online magazine, is Valley Screen and Stage.
Yeah.
But the way you get to it is just put davidappleford.com.
Yeah.
And it'll direct you directly to it.
And that's APP, like Apple, APPLE. And
F-O-R-D.
And Ford.
Right.
Appleford.
And what you'll see on the homepage is the most recent additions, which would be either film or theater. For instance, there are two new films there, The Jungle Book, which I heard Joseph talk about very well in the last hour.
That's right.
And then there's the other film that I don't know if it was mentioned. It's from New Zealand, called The Dark Horse.
Oh.
Yes.
And it was voted as, it's considered to be one of the best films from New Zealand ever.
Oh, nice.
So we can now see that here in town, too.
Wow.
And that's based on a true story.
True story.
Yeah.
Can you believe this hour has zipped by?
I thought we wouldn't have enough to talk about.
This is great. David Appleford, film critic, theater critic, thank you so much for joining us today. Eric, Kathleen, always nice seeing you guys. A little bit country, a little bit rock and roll. Tricia, thank you, especially for doing a great job. You and Joseph from 9 to 11.
Woohoo!
I didn't even have to come in and rescue the situation. These guys are professionals. All right, so we'll see everyone next week. Great surprise in-studio guest next week. Michelle Harvey, we'll see everyone next week.
It's now time for the word association game. Contestants, go ahead.
Bars, meat market, gas,
high prices,
politicians,
liars,
auto mechanics,
ripoff.
Guys, whoa, 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 wait a minute here. Not when I think of my auto mechanic, I think of trust, care, safety, and fairness. This sounds like the definition of a friend, which was what Alexander's All Care Automotive Repair achieves with his customers. The peace of mind that comes with a mechanic that puts you first. Located at 3310 East Thomas Road, Phoenix, 85018. Call 602-956-3781. 602-956-3781.
Do you owe money to the IRS? Have you heard of possible payment options such as a partial payment installment agreement, offering compromise, or not currently collectible status? Knowing that you have options and what those options are will greatly relieve your worry and stress. Hi, my name is Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor. If you are curious as to what options may be available to you if you owe money to the IRS, my 25 years experience as a CPA may very well help you in these times of uncertainty. Stop worrying and start learning about what options you have. If you just want to talk to someone about your IRS debt or want specific advice, I invite you to call me at 602-625-3074. That is 602-625-3074. And when you call, ask for me, Dave Isaac, CPA and former government tax auditor.
At Birenbaum and Spien PC, we want to help you work on your business, not in your business. We take a simple approach. You know your business. Our firm gives you the information to make those decisions better. Our firm takes a proactive approach to your accounting needs, and if you look behind the numbers, you'll find there are hidden opportunities that we try to impart on you. Communication is the key to that understanding, and there is no charge for brief phone calls. Contact us at 602-266-5633 or email us at mitch@jfbpc.com. Birenbaum and Spien works to increase your understanding of your business in order to make the decisions necessary to move your business forward.
This is 1480 KP.